everyone. Welcome to Aristocrits. I am your host and normally DM, Clay Larson. You might notice I'm not in my normal seat today because today I am not hosting, I am playing. And also you might note, if you can see this back here, we are not normally as we are going on a quest in a D&D land. Instead, we're going out to the stars in a Star Wars adventure.
DM'd
by our friend Mark McCora, who's been on the show before. And we also have two other guests, Lindsay Hahn.
Hello.
And Jen Kruger.
Hello.
If you guys want to vote, we're still going to be doing some votes. You can vote on things as the show goes on at jash.com/play. If you want to watch older episodes, if you're like, no, I hate Star Wars, I want D&D, go to youtube.com/jashplay. You've got our older episodes up there. And I'm just going to throw it over to Mark now to start us off on whatever we're gonna do.
Yeah. Let's all just imagine that we have a giant credit roll coming down right now, and it's taking us to a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Specifically, where we are starting is the spaceport of Mos Eisley on the planet of Tatooine. And even more particularly than that, we have traveled down just a little bit of a shady alley off the main vistas of the spaceport to a little place called Tlycon Mybar's Career Services and Tea House. And Tlycon Mybar's right now has three, one creature and two droids waiting in the waiting room. And perhaps those characters would like to introduce themselves a little bit. Right now, there's no one actually in the waiting room aside from them, but there is a blast door and a security camera that seems to be panning from character to character, just making sure that no one is doing anything hinky at the moment.
Hinky.
So
you go.
Me? All right.
Yeah, you start. It's your show, Clay.
I've never had to do this part.
I know.
Hello, I am SE3PO, a special edition 3PO unit that was a grand prize received by sending in purchase codes from a breakfast cereal popular in the Empire called Blaster Bites. I am a regular protocol droid. However, I served a little girl named Fane Zendu, who eventually grew up and got rid of me.
it's a sad world
so
for
sad.
Unwanted droids in the Star Wars universe. If you didn't know that, droids are supposed to have masters who really take care of them. And, you know, when droids don't have masters, they sometimes get treated like property and objects by people who are around. But
oh, I still have a master, sir.
Oh, you do? Do you?
The maker of Blaster Bites, Morgath Industries.
Oh, wonderful. Well, a corporate overlord then for SE 3PO, which is probably the best master that someone can get, and probably who's going to be all of our masters in just a few short years.
Quite so.
There's another droid who's also seeming to be carousing in the corner a little bit.
Introduction. I am 21BZ43. I am a medical droid, proficient in surgery. However, recently my memory banks have become completely depleted, so I am seeking to refill them. The most efficient manner to refill these memory banks is to dissect every creature that I encounter that is not currently in my memory banks.
Wonderful, wonderful. I'm sure that will help this lovely droid meet many, many friends within this quite diverse population of Mos Eisley. And then there's one, let's say, about half-size creature who's sitting in the waiting room, also clanking about just a little bit, but not entirely metal.
Hello, I am Hubutu. I'm an Ewok cyborg pirate, kidnapped as a child by a Sith scientist who surgically fitted me with experimental Bavkar cybernetic components and sold me to a corrupt Republican senator who used my enhanced senses to track exotic dragons. I am Poopoo 2, managed to escape by means of my own wits and cunning and return to my home moon of Endor, only to be shunned as an abomination to my own people. Now, if only I could steal enough shiny things to bring back to my people and have them accept me again.
Well, Poopoo 2,
a choice.
You might just have that opportunity during this adventure. So you're all in this this room that's got this blast door and this camera. Is there anything that you want to particularly do right now? Are you gonna stay in the room? Are you gonna try to go inside? Are you gonna?
I look up at the camera and wave at it and say, "Hello."
The camera focuses in on you, nods, and then the blast door opens up. Oh. And a little bit of haze comes out of it.
I think they heard me.
Is that a living creature?
It is a living creature. And this is an Athorian. And he is, you might recognize him as the hammerhead described species within the Star Wars universe. And this is, in fact, the owner of the establishment, Tlycon Mybar.
Hello, I've noticed that you've entered my establishment. Are you perhaps looking for a career change or perhaps just a taste of delightful chai?
Well, as appealing as that chai is, I do need to acquire some shiny things, so maybe I need some money.
Well, I just happen to have gotten a new assignment, and perhaps you three... Well, yes, are you a medical droid?
Yes.
Oh, medical droid might be exactly perfect for this task. Yes. We have a client who has requested for a procedure to be done. It's not on, let's say, a more... Are you perhaps specialized in any sort of species as a medical droid?
I am equally proficient in all species.
Well, that is perfect in this situation. Yes, 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 you three shall do for this adventure. I will send you off, please, head to Hangar 99. Do you know where that's located in the spaceport?
No. But I have excellent tracking skills. Maybe I could... No, that doesn't make sense. Go, you go.
I'm sure we can talk to someone. I speak over 6 million languages.
Well, that is quite convenient. Quite convenient indeed. Because the person that you are looking for at Hangar 99 will be on a skiff, and he will be a Gamorrean. You may be familiar with them. Gamorreans have tusks and quite a roundish piggy sort of nose, and you're generally overweight and smell horrible. So maybe if you do have tracking skills, that might come into use too.
Perfect.
Wonderful, wonderful. Yes, yes, go to Hangar 99, look for the Gamorrean, and you shall find yourself a job. It's what we all need these days, isn't it? It's a tough economy here in Mos Eisley. Yes. Mm.
Excellent.
Excellent. So, what do you guys want to do? Are you guys going to just try to find your way to the hangar, or are you going to...
Is this room literally just, like, a metal box with a door and a camera, or is there anything else in here?
There's definitely more space behind. Mm-hmm. There is a small, like, tea station that appears to look somewhere between, like, an old-school espresso machine and one of those tea carafes. So if you wanted a spot of tea before you left, you could probably enjoy one of those.
I always love chai.
No. Should we move on?
What are you guys
get off
thinking?
The tea.
Oh, I can't drink tea.
That's what I said. So what are you doing here? Are you just going to sit here and wait for me to invite you to leave, or?
Can I speak the hammerhead? What was it again?
Athorian
language?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Do I have to roll for it or anything, or? Or do I just know?
You can go for a roll. Yeah. You go for a roll.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So three dice.
Yes.
That is.
Yeah, you speak Athorian.
Okay, great.
Nice.
is there anything specific that sounds like?
Well, it comes out in stereo because they have mouths on both sides of their head, And I think that it's like something like a sing song mixed with like a dolphin kind of click language. So it's like a.
Okay, so you hear from the sides of SE3PO's head, there's like two speakers on either side, so it comes out also in stereo. Mm-hmm. But you hear do you want me to just tell you that?
Yeah.
Have you heard of Blaster Bites, a complete part of this nutritious breakfast? You seem like you may not have had a good enough breakfast today.
And he explains that he's actually suffering from celiac disease, and so he has to be gluten-free at this particular moment, and so Blaster Bites is not really the best for him, but he appreciates the offer.
Might I suggest Nice Bar Bofa Treats, also sold by Morgath Industries?
At this point, he's really trying to stay eating organic. His people are known for trying to stay, you know, within communion with planets and, you know, the rest of the intergalactic celestial system. So processed food is not really his favorite thing.
Medical inquiry. Might I remove one of your mouths and part of your stomach to study and better fill my memory banks?
Well, perhaps you might have some sort of endoscopic type tool, which you could send into my mouth if you need to do a little bit of research, but I wouldn't like to be cut open in any sort of way. That would not be good for my day, I do not believe.
I have anything that I can do? I won't cut into him if you didn't give me permission, but
you have an endoscopic tool that you can go in there, and if you want to send a camera down into his digestive tract, you can do that.
Totally, yeah. Okay. How many dice should I roll for that?
I guess the question is, how far do you want to get in there?
I want to go through the whole system as far as I can go.
Okay.
I need as big of a picture as I can get.
Okay. All right. Yeah, go for a roll there.
Is that, medicine or surgery?
Yeah,
or?
So I think that would be let's just call that the technical skill because since you've gone for the memory wipe, you know.
14.
Yeah, so so you start feeding the endoscopic camera.
Bedside manner engaging. This will not hurt a bit.
And so you start feeding it down into his mouth, and it takes, you know, just a few moments, and he's kind of shuddering, standing there, regular speaking through the other mouth. Not as comfortable as I had expected. Perhaps you could have put some sort of jelly on it or something before it went all the way in her house, yes! And so then what you do is you actually see the endoscopic camera now has come all the way down. It's even though yards and yards of this endoscopic camera have come in, or I should say meters and meters in the Star Wars universe, has gone through, and is now reaching out through the other mouth. So you've actually gone through his stomachs down to the other esophagus that he has, and it's reaching now out through his other mouth.
Oh my.
Appreciative comment. Thank you for your time.
Roll it back. Well, that was more exciting than I anticipated.
Have a wonderful day.
Your presence here was absolutely lovely.
Yay.
That's nice.
Okay, so are you guys going to just head out onto the street in Mos Eisley?
I guess.
Yeah.
Shall we?
Wonderful.
Well, sure.
So you walk out, and per usual in Mos Eisley, it is an absolutely sunny, blistering day. There's very little respite from the heat. But probably the only person who's actually feeling that is our Ewok pirate friend covered in hair. Maybe, she has some sort of cybernetic temperature adjustment system that can help regulate her journey here on Tatooine. And now you've made it to kind of like a big, broad street that's filled with, you know, larger shops, And then there's like tiny little shops, kind of like shanty shops that are built in front of that. So it's got kind of like a bizarre feeling, but it also, you can see that there are cantinas, there are restaurants, there's not just shops, there's all kinds of different options of things that you can go to. And you're also seeing, you know, starships lifting up from the main hangar, which appears to be just like about a click away. And then you've got, you know, smaller hangars that are all built around that as well.
All right.
And there's all sorts of people that are on the street, humans, non-humans. You don't really see very many other droids that aren't being accompanied by some sort of master. But you're also seeing, you know, this is the Galactic Rim. So, you know, slavery here is totally in effect. You've got, you know, people who are being led in chains to different places to be sold. You've got various different toughs, people who you wouldn't want to, you know, see in a dark alley.
I approach literally the first humanoid who comes anywhere near us.
Okay. Wait, think about it. Okay.
All right. And,
observation, good idea.
And excuse me, sir.
What is it? What do you want?
This is one of the famous Shiveston Wolfman, right? Ooh. And so he literally looks like a walking, talking wolf. And he also appears to be quite a bit hungover. So he's not really in, like, maybe let's say, the most cooperative mood. Do you want to take a roll to persuade him to actually talk to you?
Sure. So that's under perception?
Yeah, that's under
perception. So big ol' 1D. It's a 4.
What do you want? I just have a moment. What do you want?
What
do you want? I have a moment. I need to go.
Wonderful. Well, we were wondering if you might be able to direct us to the shortest path to the nearby Hangar 99.
Hangars are all over there. Just leave me alone.
Medical inquiry. Might I take a
I have no time.
Are you
suffering? Need my medicine. Wait, do you have medicine?
I am a surgical droid.
Are you equipped with any sort of pharmaceuticals?
Am I?
You do have one. You have essentially like a syringe that's filled with about like 10 different sorts of, 10 different doses of like a very strong type of opioid.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
This unit is equipped with some medicine that might help to relieve any discomfort you are feeling in this moment in exchange for allowing me to take a sample of your DNA.
Hmm. So you've got the good stuff, that's what you're telling me? Because you can have my DNA if you've got the good stuff.
If I might interject.
Affirmative comment. Yes, I have the good stuff.
Yes.
I would also suggest, instead of drugs, you could deal with your hangover with a nice tall glass of open sky bristle melon juice.
Juice?
Rich with vitamin C and other antioxidants.
Thing, or an opioid.
Copyright, Morgath Industries.
Yeah, that's. So where did you need to go now? What are you doing? What are you doing here? You need to go to Hangar 99?
My friends and I are trying to go to Hangar 99.
Well, I can walk you. Oh, yeah, this is really good stuff. Maybe about halfway there, and I might have to lay down in a storefront someplace, so. So he actually starts leading you right over to where Hangar 99 is.
Fantastic.
I want to prep my surgical laser while we're walking.
He gets, you know, about 300 meters, which is about 3/4 way. He's leaning against the storefront, and he's like, yeah, this is as far as I'm going here. Oh yeah, I'm just gonna sit down here, take a little break. Yeah, just hang it. And he literally sits down just right in the middle of a doorway and pretty much passes out.
Right. I'm going to cut off his ear.
Okay. So, you want to just, are you trying to, like, really just, like, cut off his ear? Are you trying to, like, you know, surgically remove it in a way that's, you know, not going to, like, you know, do much damage? You're just going to leave him bleeding in the street. Like, what is your plan here?
I want to, you know, surgically remove it so it won't, you know, make much damage, and then I can cauterize the wound afterwards so it won't bleed. But I'd like, you know, blood, tissue, hair samples all together in one place that's easily removable. I feel like an ear is a good way to go.
What are you doing, Z4?
Oh, I am trying to replete my memory banks. They have been deleted. I do not know what happened. But to better treat one of these types of creatures in the future, if I take samples of his skin and blood and hair, I will have more knowledge about his entire species.
Yes, that checks out.
So you want to give it a roll and see how effective you are?
Yeah. All right.
He clearly is suffering from a memory wipe.
12.
Yeah, so you actually do a really impressive surgery here, you know? It's like he's got this really huge, you know, wolfen-type ear that's extending out. And you find where there's like a nice little fold in the ear, right? And you cut right along that fold. So it's great. Like he's got like really just like a third of an ear left. It's not like you've cut off the entire ear, but you have a lot of hair coming up along the black around the back. You've got you know, a little bit of blood that's coming out of the ear. So you've got a really great sample here.
Awesome.
Is there anything shiny on this wolf that I could have?
Well, you might. Yeah, I mean, you want to give a little search roll there?
Yes. Is that four dice? Is that what I do?
Yeah. So.
All right.
Yeah, you've got the 4D, and you've got a plus one.
Oh.
Yeah, and so what you find is what appears to be some sort of religious, like, metal beads that are, like, hidden in his pocket. And it's got a full moon with, like, a wolf howling at the full moon as, like, the main medallion on it. But it's... Yeah, like it's got a full string of like over 100 really shiny little beads on it.
Oh, this will go great with my fabulous backpack.
So at this point, what are you guys gonna do? You're gonna head into the hangar? Or you're gonna keep on playing out here?
Shall I sniff out the fellow we are looking for, or should we continue forward and explore?
Sure, if you are able to sniff him out.
I can. I have tracking skills.
Observational comment. I would much like to see your tracking skills in action. And also later to have a part of your body.
Fantastic. How many dice do I roll?
Yeah, so...
Looking for forgotten what on a which on a skiff?
It's a Gamorrean.
Gamorrean, so yeah. So it's a big, well, there couldn't be that many Gamorreans on skiffs.
You're gonna go for a 4D.
Okay.
Another 4D perception.
Another 4D. All right.
There are quite a bit of intense smells actually on this street. There's there appears to be maybe down an alley a store that's cooking huge pots of soup that has a really strong, almost like a spicy curry-ish flavor. There's a cantina that you can smell that just has like all sorts of booze coming from it. There's even then a little at that entrance there appears to be maybe that they washed off some vomit from last night.
Mm-hmm.
But you're smelling so many strong smells that you can't actually pick out the Gamorrean.
Okay.
So,
which direction do we go in, Poo-Poo 2?
The alley seems okay. There's food there.
Right.
And it seems like that probably leads to something.
Deductive reasoning. Where there are food, there are creatures who eat food.
Oh, good point. That's what I was saying the whole time.
Well, excellent. Let's move on then, shall we?
So you guys head down this alley, and get to what appears to be a, you know, a restaurant that is really like an open counter that has all sorts of huge troughs of food that they're cooking on giant burners. They've got different meats that are hanging up from different hooks. They've got a really a filthy, dirty, tusked man who's running the who's running the actual counter, and he takes a look and he's like, "What do you want to eat? I see one of you maybe eat something, but two of you eat nothing. So why do you come here to see it?"
"Excuse me, sir."
"Yeah, what do you want? You want food? I get you food. You want food?"
"Do you have anything by Morgath Industries?"
"No, no, no, no. We can't get things like that out here on the rim. Not for a good price. You, what do you think? You are some rich person or something like that? Is that what you, what do you even want from Morgath Industries? Maybe some oil or something? I don't know. Maybe some computer chips? I don't know these things. We don't have those things for you here. What are you? You are a cyborg thing? You want..."
"Yes."
"You want some... What do you want here?"
"The rawer, the better.
The raw.
Any meat. Rob meat.
Well, I have these entrails down here that we cut out from what we made last night. We've had in the smoker all night. These entrails, they've only been out all night.
It's they smell cool. Horrible. I'll cool. Take them."
"Oh, well, wonderful. Well, that will be, let me see here, 15 credits?"
"Oh. Does anybody... I have 5. Anybody else?"
"5 credits?
I appear to have none."
"You have 5 credits? You want my fine entrails? You know how hard it is to capture things that are alive on this planet. All right, what I'll give, I'll give you the entrails. To be honest, I was going to throw them away anyways. 5 credits."
"Oh, success."
"Yes. Yes, success for us both."
"Yes." "I have a question. You said he has tusks? Is he a Gamorrean?"
"No, he's not a Gamorrean."
"Okay."
"He's not.
Okay.
He's got, but he's,
do
he's
I,
a lot smaller than a... You can, yeah, do you want
to
take
roll
a roll to
see
find
if I
out
think,
what he
if
is?
I, yeah, to see what he is?
Yeah.
What do I... Knowledge? Oh, yeah, alien species. That is 14.
So what you recognize him as is a Fartar. Which is which is a species that is really known for having a bad attitude and a horrible smell, but is not anywhere near the size of a Gamorrean. Definitely not any sort of tough thing. But perhaps he might have some information.
I'm streetwise. It says I can roll 2 dice to be streetwise. Will that give me any kind of like knowledge as to how to deal with him?
Yeah.
Shall I roll for that
you
before
want,
we
you
proceed?
Want to go for a little streetwise roll.
Nice.
Oh,
ooh.
I can't. Anytime I roll 2 of the highest dice, I get shorted out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you have now...
I'm paralyzed.
You have now shorted out. You're paralyzed for a full turn. And your partners in crime here actually have no way... They don't know how to deal with you at all.
"Don't worry, Poo Poo 2. I'll take care of this. And I'll roll streetwise check."
And I'm engaging bedside manner. "Don't worry, Tutu Poo. I will fix you."
You can actually take this opportunity. All right, so you're rolling first.
I'll roll a streetwise.
Yeah, you got that
first. To what I assume she was trying to ask. It's a 3 on my 1D for perception, right?
Yeah.
So 3. And I start saying, "Hey, man. We are looking for any Gamorreans. They look like you, but larger and stronger."
Where are you trying to go? Someplace in particular to meet this Gamorrean or something? What do you?
We were told the Gamorrean was on a skiff.
Anywhere in particular that you might remember, maybe?
Hangar 99.
Ah, Hangar 99. Yes, that's Hangar 99. You go out back on there to the main street. You make a right. You just go down, I would say maybe 300 meters. It'll be on your left, very easy to get to. You want to go?
I hold out my fist for a bump.
Okay, he just bumps it right back, you know? Like,
you go, have a good day. Get out of the way. Droids don't do good for my food business. People think I must be serving weird things.
So, before you leave, are you going to do anything?
One of the 6 million languages I speak is the streets.
I'm going to, first I want to, I'm concerned for my companion here, so I want to use my needle to prick, like, her paw to get a blood sample, see if I can figure out what's wrong with her.
Okay.
Is Poo-Poo too, like, incapacitated?
Yeah, so maybe I can revive her if I get a blood sample going here, so or at least figure out what's wrong.
Yeah.
11.
Yeah. So from the blood sample, what you've noticed is that her entire body is going through some sort of heavy electrical charge.
Okay.
And it's actually like. Disrupting her at her flesh parts at a molecular level.
Can I defibrillate her?
yeah, you want to try to get that
Yeah. That seems like a reasonable thing to do. 3.
It's all ones.
It's all ones.
There's a bit of arcing as it jumps, you know, from your defibrillator pad to her. And while it brings the flesh parts of her alive, it also short circuits her arm for what's gonna be the next 6 turns.
No, edit comment. I did not foresee this outcome. But your flesh parts are working now.
Thank you.
Turn to the bartender. Inquiry. May I take a sample of your DNA?
No, that is weed crew. You go! You go now! I tell Droid to leave!
Response. Reasonable.
Okay.
You seem fine now, Poo-Poo, too. Let's move on.
Sounds great, except for this dead arm I got, but, you know, this one can't leave good enough alone. It's fine.
Medical inquiry. Would you like me to look at your arm?
It's not soft tissue. Can you do anything about that?
Let's find out!
Oh, God!
What are you rolling?
No, persuasion. No, roll persuasion.
Would it be technical?
Roll persuasion. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Good.
Do persuasion?
Yeah, I want you to roll persuasion.
7.
Okay, you roll your perception.
Oh, gosh.
It's how 4D many? Plus 1. 4.
Plus, yeah, she's going to know another... this is not a good idea.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, so,
10.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You don't think this is a good idea, so.
No!
All right!
That sounds horrible. Great.
Whew. All right, so you guys going to head down to the hangar now that you got the clear directions, or what do you think? You're back out on the main street, maybe, or?
And he told us to go that direction to Hangar 99.
Yes. Affirmative.
Okay. Yeah. Should I use my streetwise to see if we should talk to anybody else on the street?
See
if there's anybody else we could, I could maybe get some information from?
Sure.
Does that sound crazy? Does that sound nuts? Does that sound totally crazy? Would it be under perception or knowledge?
Streetwise is under knowledge, 2D.
Okay, 2. 10.
I mean, there are a lot of people that you could be talking to on the street about any number of things.
All right.
What you also notice is that they're actually, in basic symbols on one of the hangars as to what the hangar number is.
Oh, that's great perception.
Yeah, and that is labeled as Hangar 97.
Oh, well, we just have to go 2 more and we'll get there.
Excellent.
So, as you guys are walking down the street, one of the things that you notice, Poo-Poo, is that you move a lot faster than these droids. These droids move about half your speed. So, do you want to head, first and get there first, or are you going to stick with the rest of your crew?
Ooh, maybe I should head there first. Just to see it. Is that a dumb move? Is that a rookie move?
Are you asking me?
Yes.
You're asking as a character? Or yes?
I'm asking as the character. Does everybody think that's a good idea? Shall I go ahead or no?
Observation. Even if you are injured, I am capable of helping you out.
Oh.
I mean, We're going to meet the person who hired us. We probably don't need to scout it ahead of time.
All right. That makes more sense.
Also, please don't leave us.
At 99 together. And what you notice is that not even 10 feet or 10 meters inside the hangar is a small skiff. Not anything too large in any kind of way. And there's a large Gamorrean who's got a huge pike and a blaster on his hip. And he's sitting very bored, just like almost napping on the skiff.
Hello, sir! Oh, he's speaking Gamorrean. I know this. And I'm saying, we're here from Tleekon Mybars.
Yeah, I wanted to take a roll for this.
Okay. I was gonna say.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
What am I rolling for?
You're gonna roll for
knowledge,
yeah,
or
for knowledge skill.
Or persuasion.
For your knowledge skill.
Okay. That is 8.
And so, tell me what you're saying to him.
We are the workers from Tleekon Mybar Career Service and T-Bar.
And what he's saying is, yeah, I've been waiting for you for like 35 minutes. Get on the skiff.
He wants us to get on the skiff.
We've got an important place to go. Jabba doesn't wait for everybody.
Oh my, we're going to see Jabba. Do
Inquiry.
I know who Jabba is?
Who is Jabba?
And what he's saying is, you don't know who Jabba the Hutt is? He's only the most powerful crime lord in this part of the galaxy. And so what are you guys going to do? You going to get on the skiff? You going to head over to Jabba's or what?
Oh, my.
I think we've got to do it, guys.
Observation. Criminals often hold other people prisoner. There will probably be lots of people there for me to take samples from.
Well, we were hired for a job, so let's do it.
Let's do it.
Oh, great.
Affirmative.
Great. Well, so you guys get onto the skiff, and the repulsor lift engines lift you up out of the hangar, and you're cruising over the top of Mos Eisley, and you're going out into the desert, okay?
As we're going, can I ask this Gamorrean what his name is?
Yeah. And he says that his name is Porter.
Thank you for taking us, Porter.
Observation, your name and your job are the same thing.
I'm actually a bodyguard. Is what he says.
Observation, there is no one here for you to protect.
We're low staff right now at Jabba's palace. So they've got us guards doing all sorts of things.
Ah, that checks out.
So you guys have just like, you see far in the distance, Jabba's palace reaching up from the desert. And, you know, you have one opportunity here to actually get a sample from this guard if you want to.
Great. Mm-hmm. Medical inquiry. Might I take a sample of your DNA?
And what he says is there a way that you can take it without actually puncturing my skin?
Absolutely.
How are you gonna do it?
Do I have to tell him or can I just do it?
Why don't you take a persuasion roll?
Okay. 10.
Yeah, you just start doing it. He's like, he seems to be pretty nonplussed by if you don't have to pierce his skin, so. Yeah.
I'm going to use some, surgical forceps to grab one of his teeth and yank it out.
Okay, so you do that.
Excuse me, Z4, what are you doing?
That was not a good move.
The Gamorrean at this point is furious.
He seems pissed.
Okay? He takes...
Medical observation. You will be fine.
He takes a swing at you with his pike. Okay? So...
Oh, no!
So you got... Are you going to do anything? You going to try to react in time?
Yeah.
Let's make a perception roll there.
Yeah. Two.
Okay. So he knocks you straight up with this thing, all right? Okay. And what happens is that you actually, one of your arms mm-hmm. breaks straight off.
Oh,
and
no!
It's an arm that has the attachment for the drugs that you had been administering. Mm-hmm. And it also has the attachment for the surgical laser that mm-hmm. you have that you've done the modifications.
Is the arm just on the skiff still?
Yeah, so I'll grab my arm with my other arm.
Can I grab it? Oh, you
yeah,
can
I'm
grab
gonna
it.
Grab it.
I can put it in my handy backpack if anybody needs anything carried.
Is anyone gonna try to
fight him, or quiet? I mean, my arm is totally dead for six turns. I could try.
Yeah, your arm is. I think your arm is pretty good by this point.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I try to talk to the Gamora.
Okay.
Yeah, I can do. I can try to put my own arm back.
Yeah,
on.
I think probably you help got the skills. Too.
Yeah,
sir. I am so sorry about my friend's here's actions. She should not have done that. Although to be fair, you did move a little bit.
All right. So give a persuasion roll.
One. Four.
Yeah, and he snorts and nods. And he seems like he's totally relaxed as he lands the skiff as the gates to Jabba's palace opens.
Can we try and repair her arm before we get to Jabba's palace?
You have one turn.
Okay. To try, because I have droid repair too. So if it doesn't work for you.
Okay, great. Oh. I'll try to put it back on.
If you hear someone walking down the hallway to come out and meet you as the gates are closing behind you.
Six.
Yeah, and you're able to reattach it.
Great.
It's a lot right now. It's not as useful. Like, mm-hmm. you can't actually, like... bend it very much. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna have a lot less mobility with your laser.
Okay.
And you know, some of the, you're gonna really have to work even to jab somebody.
Okay.
Can I try my hand at it to try and make it even better, or is that crazy?
Yeah, if you want, yeah.
If
go
I
ahead,
don't give short
one,
out,
give her one. You got
okay.
one try.
Okay. Okay.
Seven.
Yeah, and you can't really make any sort of improvement.
Two right. Two. We need to move on.
Jeez, so comment. Thank you for trying.
A Twi'lek has come out to come meet you, and you know, they've got the two long head tails is wrapped around, and he seems to be very, very serious business, and he starts talking to you in Twi'lek, which, of course, being a common language, you understand immediately. And he says, "Why, it's taken you so long to get here. This rancor is in absolute pain and suffering right now. We need to get you into the pit before he has any sort of punishing damage to him. Oh, Jabba is so upset that his pet is harmed." And that is where we will take the break.
So, rancor, huh?
I'm yeah, super pumped. I love rancor.
Go ahead. Yeah, so when we return to the adventure, our two droids and cyborg Ewok pirate are going to be heading into the Rancor's pit.
All right.
Amazing. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm excited.
I'm very excited.
I wonder what's wrong with this rancor.
I don't know, but I bet you I can figure it out.
Thank you.
with our guests for this week, guest DM Mark McCora, Lindsay Hahn, and Jen Kruger. We're going to get going in a sec again, but just if you want a recap, actually, I'll let Mark do the recap when he takes over again for anybody who hasn't been with us the whole time. Also, if you want to vote for the adventure we're going to do on our normal show next week, it's the last week of the month, which means we're going to be doing a user-submitted adventure on Aristocrats. The options for next week are: option one, aggravated assistance, submitted by your lord and savior, Linda. And option two, the Brothers of Barrymore, submitted by Noah Hammer. And you can vote on those by going to jash.com/play right now. The Twitch stream will still be up in that window, so you can keep watching there. And vote on what adventure you want to see next week. Also, next week, we're doing our nighttime show, because we've been trying to do one of those every month. So that one, next week will be on Wednesday at, do we have a time we're starting yet, Will?
7 a.m.
About 7, where it'll be on the page. It'll be on the page. You'll find it out. Or follow our Twitter. So it'll be a nighttime show on Wednesday night, the 27th next week. And we will restream that one or our previous nighttime one. We're still figuring things out a little bit on next Thursday. But yeah, vote for which one of those you want to see. And let's get back into it.
Okay, so we're going to do a little recap to start out with. We have our three characters, the medical droid, 21B. We've got C-Po, right? That's what you're going by right now?
SE-3PO.
SE-3PO.
Which could be pronounced as C-Po.
C-Po. C-Po, who is a protocol droid. And then we've got Poo-Poo-2, who is our cyborged Ewok pirate. And they started out at Tricon Mybar's wonderful establishment to help careers and give people chai. And were given a job to go and meet someone with a skiff who ended up taking them to Jabba's palace, a Gamorrean. And along the way,
named Porter.
Yeah, named Porter. Who was sampled for his tissue, as many people along the way, many species have entered into 21B's memory bank at this point. And now our player characters are in the depths of Jabba's palace, heading towards the Rancor pit. Where you're at right now, there's very dark. There's, you know, broad hallways that are just narrowing and narrowing down as you're going deeper and deeper into the bowels of the palace, following the Twi'lek, who really has not much to say to you all per se, and leads you to the tiny little door that allows one entrance into the Rancor's pit.
I have a good feeling about this.
I don't.
Medical inquiry. Might I sample your DNA?
My DNA? No, absolutely not. What are you trying to do? Capture me?
No, I am simply a medical droid who's trying to replete depleted memory banks. I have yet to encounter someone of your species, so if you might be willing to part with a bit of blood, tissue, or one of your teeth, it would help greatly should you ever become injured or one of your kind ever become injured and need treatment from me.
How about this?
And he spits directly into your ocular sensors.
Well, that would be more helpful into this sensor, but thank you. Pat that drool into one of my sensors, because there's DNA in saliva.
Mm-hmm. And so,
that seems like a simpler way to get it than pulling that guy's tooth out, just saying.
He turns and leaves you to the huge cavernous Rancor's pit. Leaves you stranded there, and there is a human keeper who walks up to you, and he is absolutely just saddened, just heartbroken right now. He's obviously been crying. His eyes are puffy, and he says, "Please, you've come here to save my Rancor, haven't you? Because I need someone to save my dear friend. It's the only thing that I love, and I just have lost it."
I'm going to search my memory banks for what language that was.
Bedside manner engaging. Yes, we are here to help. On a scale of 1 to 10, could you rate your pain?
Our pain is very, I would say, emotional pain somewhere in the 7 to 8 range. I just moved the Rancor's. He gets like this sometimes after he eats someone that's especially tough. I suppose you really don't have the opportunity to take the body armor off of them first.
What is your name, sir?
My name is Syot. I've been the Rancor's keeper for the last 10 years. He's the only thing that's dear to me. He's like my child. I raised him from a little bitty Rancor, which is just about 2 meters tall, but so adorable. You just see how they can tear apart any sort of cattle. They play with them. It's adorable.
Inquiry. How about how many years would you say it took the Rancor to reach maturity?
It takes about 3 years. Three or five years for it to get to its full. 3 years is huge. 5 years is an enormous killing machine that knows how to take anything apart. Yes.
Excellent.
How old is it right now?
He's about 7 years old.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. He's got a good 20 more years left his Rancor life before we'll have to put him down. But, you know, he's eat at least another 3,000, 4,000 prisoners by then.
Oh. Mm-hmm. One can only hope.
He's led you all the way across the, you know, infamous pit of death, where the Rancor, you know, takes out any sort of people the Jabba wishes to punish for his amusement, and leads you to kind of like a cave, kind of part of it that has a giant metal grate in front of it that's got a door, small little door. That he opens up and leads you to. Here you just smell like, you know, death and viscera and absolutely just intense, wretched smell of the Rancor, who is laying down in a corner and appears to be lightly wailing.
A quick question. Mm-hmm. I can roll for this. Rancors are beasts, right?
They're beasts.
They're not like, they don't speak a language. Right?
No. Okay. They don't, you could maybe get some sort of like emotional read, but you know, I think you're pretty much getting.
Oh,
that.
No, I couldn't.
could I use my enhanced sense of smell to maybe be able to detect what's wrong? I mean, is it just an upset stomach or do we think that it's like more than that?
Well, you can try to use your sense of smell if you'd like, but there may be, you know, easier ways to get that kind of information.
All right, we have a medical cyborg. Not a cyborg, a droid.
Examination commencing. I'll go over to the Rancor and shine a light in its eyes, check its pupils for dilation.
I would stay away from that end of the Rancor if I were you. It's just because he's incapacitated doesn't mean that he wouldn't bite anything, and he could crush a droid in his mandibles, no question.
Ah, oh my. Thank you. Back up. You said he ate something that disagreed with him.
The droids, they do that every so often. They just parts get stuck when they have to eat something that's covered in armor. It gets cut somewhere along the lines in its intestinal tract, and we can't find a way to get to it. We just need to find some way to extract it.
Surgery?
Yes, I have a laser.
Oh, I wouldn't surge. No, we can't. If we were to cut open the Rancor, it wouldn't be able to fight for weeks or months. Jabba would have my head then. It would feed me piece by piece to the Rancor. No, there has to be some other way that we can get to it. Usually we have to actually extract it manually.
If only we had someone small enough to go into the mouth of a Rancor.
Yes, if only.
No, I wouldn't head.
Oh, thank God.
That's not the way that I would go.
Medical observation. Most beasts have an opening on both ends.
No.
The ones that I have noticed walking around, perhaps you would fit in the other.
Oh, God.
In the meantime, I will take a tissue sample to see if I can glean anything else that might be helpful to our cause.
All right, so you want to take a sample?
Oh, jeez.
2-1-B.
Yes?
I'm going to just caution you. Maybe we should wait. And do you have anything you can inject into the Rancor?
Yes, I have more opioid.
Do you have enough opioid for a Rancor?
Well, because the Rancor is not yet completely fully filled out in my memory banks, I only have what this gentleman has told me. I can only take my best guess, which is yes.
You don't have any calculations based on size or weight?
Well, that is where my best guess is coming from. That gentleman we met earlier, I gave one dose, and it seemed to be enough to knock him flat. I have 9 remaining. If I give all 9 to the Rancor, it should knock it out.
I turn and just kind of like lowly talk to Poopoo too, say like, oh dear, I do believe this memory wipe has gotten rid of nearly everything that could have been helpful from her memory banks.
I'm terrified.
Let me object to the plan.
Well, I think that's all we can do at this point.
So you're gonna shoot it up first, right?
That's your first. Well away from the head. Okay. After the warning I was given about it, but in fact, I would say like maybe close to the rear in the hope of loosening the sphincter.
Okay.
All right. Yes. Do you also have any muscle relaxers aside from the opioid?
Do I?
I think the opioids. You have muscle relaxers as well, so you can administer some muscle relaxers. Okay, so
you also have lube.
No. I am not that kind of droid.
If I may make a suggestion, unload everything.
Well,
unload everything into the Rancor.
I do not think that would be a good idea, as I do have some amphetamines.
Oh.
Unload everything except the amphetamines.
All right. The downers, please.
Yes. All right.
Okay.
11.
All right, yeah, so you're able to slip in between the tiny little legs of the Rancor, which are just like crouched up behind it. And you kind of like use your shoulder mechanism to prop up your arm and just completely inject the Rancor with all of your opioids as well as muscle relaxers and a liquid of horrible stench just immediately lets out from the hole below the tail of the Rancor.
Well, I cleaned it out for you.
There's the lube I was looking for. Okay.
This must be terrible for your organic side.
So you guys are immediately going into this plan, right? This is like,
I mean, do we have any other choice but to go up its butthole? I don't think so.
Well,
to be fair, Poopoo too, you would be the one going up its butthole.
We are
much too large.
I mean, you still do have the endoscopic camera.
Oh!
You know, remember? I'm trying to get in the way of things. That's where we want to go first. We can go right there, guys.
If you would like, I could scope him first, but
I think that's great.
My analysis matrix suggests that whether or not I scope him first, you will be entering him one way or another. So I would suggest we cut to the chase.
That's a good point. Because the camera can't really remove anything.
No, it cannot.
Do we have comms or anything? Like a way to communicate?
From inside?
With each other? Yeah, you guys have comms. Yeah, little comms.
Great.
So you can all set them to the same channel and, attempt to,
Syot.
Yes, what is it?
I have a question. Do you know if comm signals go through Rancor flesh?
I've never tried to do that, but I would assume yes. Why not?
Wonderful.
Okay.
What a wonderful plan. Let's go through with this.
Right. Affirmative.
Shall I roll for anything or just go?
Yeah, no, I mean, like the first roll that you're going to make, I think, is strength roll?
Okay. Here I go. All right. Oh, God.
We have utmost confidence in you, Poopoo 2.
Okay, 10. Oh, plus 2. 12.
Yeah, so you're able to just, you know, slip through the first stage. But, you know, they're
like
really...
Like a wet banana right up in there.
There really isn't very much, like, I mean, you're inside the cavity of a giant beast, but it's like, you know, and it's like, it's kind of giving way around you.
Yeah.
But it's like, there's like, not too much, you know, you can't really move around that much inside there. You know what I mean? Uh-huh. So what you're going to have to do is do a little dexterity roll.
All right.
See, like, if you okay. can, like, at this point, you're also, you're not really, I mean, you didn't, like... You don't have, like, any kind of, like, lights or, like, heat
right.
vision.
Do I
you
just
have any sort of heat vision
I just realized
your, like,
that maybe that would
parts,
help. I have exceptional sight and hearing.
Okay, well, yeah, if you have exceptional sight and hearing, we'll put in that you have a heat vision
yes.
capacity to that.
Yes. And, yeah, I got a little eye thing.
And so you're kind of, what you're seeing right, actually, oh, wait.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah. So you're actually getting, like, a really clear view, like, almost like predator vision
cool.
of the inside of, like, what this thing looks like. Like, you're seeing, like, different organs that are, like, obviously very hot that are, you know, like, probably, like, kidneys or livers that are, like, filtration organs. You're seeing somewhat of a path through, you know, this ginormous... colon that's like wrapping around its abdominal cavity, and across the other side of the abdominal cavity, you're actually seeing one really dark piece that doesn't look to be any sort of flesh at all. And it's, I would say that it looks to be about the size of, you know, a large watermelon or something like that.
Right.
Or what would that be if just. Does Morgrath Industries have some sort of genetically modified melony kind of thing?
That would probably be the size of either a Hubba Gourd or a bristle melon.
Yes.
Also, can I ask 2-1-B a medical question?
Yeah.
2-1-B.
Yes?
In your memory banks that haven't been wet, do you have any information on how long the intestine of a rancor is?
No.
No.
Poopoo 2, if you could, while you are there, try to get a sense of how far you are crawling and let that
also, can you hear us, Poopoo 2?
Oh, yes.
Don't we have a comm? Yes.
I'm just making sure it's working.
Yes, I can. Over.
Make as many observations about the anatomy of the rancor as you can.
All right. So should I roll a perception roll?
Yeah, so, yeah, and actually the audience at this point has made a suggestion that we can check out. Just, if we want to suggest to Poopoo 2 that you locate and punch the Rancor's prostate, which, do you have any information on the inside of the Rancor?
I guess I should roll for it.
Yeah, why don't you give a little roll?
This sounds like a horrible idea.
Yeah, I don't see what that
what
would help.
What a terrible suggestion.
Oh, 15.
So, okay. So what you know is that the Rancor doesn't actually have a prostate, so we don't.
Sorry, audience.
The Rancor's copulation is much like a cat's, all based around pain and dominance.
Aggression.
Instead of actually pleasure, the way that, you know, any normal humanoids is, you know.
Poopoo 2, if it makes you feel any better, what you were doing right now makes you the dominant party to this Rancor.
Yes.
Oh, how delightful. Maybe they'll have a relationship after.
That would be adorable.
I love being in the power position.
How do you define adorable, 2-1-B?
Well, I think that the Rancor is adorable, and I think that Ewoks are adorable, so the combination of the two would mean more adorableness.
Oh my. Do you just believe any organic being is adorable?
No, all of the other ones we've met have been terrible.
Even the humans.
So far, yes. Well, no, I take that back. Syot is very nice. Speaking of, might I have a sample of your DNA, Syot?
Human DNA? Why do you need any sort of human DNA? We're like one of the most common species, if not the most common species in the galaxy. You're a medical droid.
Most of my memory banks have been depleted, and I'm trying to fill them back up, if you wouldn't mind providing me with a bit of blood or tissue or hair or a tooth. Or even some saliva. Please,
guys,
not in my ocular.
I'm just sitting here in this colon right now, really wondering what I'm supposed to do.
Poo-poo-too, please get on with your mission. We are having a very important discussion out here.
You're supposed to be looking for the blockage.
I haven't rolled for any perception.
Come
anything.
On now, Poo-poo-too. Be a professional.
There it is. You just need to do
I've got to roll a dexterity
roll to just climb up this colon, okay?
All right, so maybe I shall do that first.
Yeah, what?
Okay. Ooh, oh, wow. Wait, two or more die.
Oh, yes.
Oh, no.
You're on the fritz. No. You're on the fritz for six rounds.
Poo-poo can we tell that from out here?
No. No.
Poo-poo two?
Maybe if you...
Poo-poo two. Poo-poo you, two, answer me.
The Rancor right now, even though it's fully opioided out, it's just like...
That bag of guts and bolts is not responding to me.
Hmm.
What is your partner doing in there? Does he think this is some sort of carnival ride?
Hypothesis. No, that is unlikely that Poo-Poo 2 would believe this beast to be a carnival ride. However, thinking about earlier, there was a point where Poo-Poo 2 just shorted out, and perhaps the same thing has happened again? I could try defibrillating the Rancor in the hopes that a smaller charge might reach Poo-Poo 2 through the hide. But of course, it may negate the effects of the opioids and muscle relaxants which I injected the Rancor with.
That seems like a really, like a possible thing to happen, especially when you've got one of your teammates inside. Actually, the Rancor might not be...
What do you think, 3PO?
I mean, you know...
Honestly, it seems like being inside of the Rancor right now might be the safest place to be.
Good observation.
What are you going to, my poor baby? My baby is in so much pain. Are you doing nothing? Why would Jabba's not going to pay?
Yeah, did you father this creature? I have to alter the hypothesis that I have made about many things if you are this creature's biological parent.
It's emotional parentage. I am like its adopted parent.
2-1-B, I have a question. When did you get your memory wiped?
Yesterday.
Was it? Yeah, it was yesterday. Okay. I was going to say, at the rate that you are absorbing new information, it seems like you should have been caught up by now. But if it just happened yesterday, I guess that makes sense.
Yes. As you have seen, many people do not like to give samples.
Well, if I might make a suggestion.
Yes.
You don't have any tact when asking.
So, engage bedside manner first is your suggestion?
Yes, honestly, with your personality unit, you should probably have bedside manner engaged at all points.
Ah, thank you for this helpful suggestion. Engaging bedside manner permanently.
Oh, dear.
Why are you smiling? My beautiful baby is in so much pain.
But he will be fine. Everything will be all right, even if the factual evidence seems to dictate to the contrary.
I don't like these words you said.
Ah, tears. Thank you. I'll wipe some of his tears off.
Okay. All right, great. So what are you going to do? You guys going to leave your partner?
How many rounds has that been?
Three. I'd say you're
back. Oh, my gosh.
Three or four. You're at four rounds. There's two more rounds. Are you going to do anything to attempt to help? Or
I try to talk to Poo-Poo 2. Yeah. If you can hear us, give us a sign.
3PO.
Did I hear that?
Yes. Yeah, you heard that.
I heard an Ewok whine.
Do you have any fizzy drinks from Morgoth Industries on your person?
Oh, if you want to know about any fizzy drinks from Morgoth Industries, such as Fizzy Bip, coming in Plasma Berry, Extreme Bristlemelon, or Puzzle Flower flavor, feel free to make any inquiries.
Well, I was thinking perhaps if we were to take a carbonated beverage, shake it up, open it, into the Rancor's anal cavity, perhaps the spray might reach our friend and revive her.
Syat, do you have any Morgeth Industries copyrighted fizzy berry drinks available in Jabba's Palace?
Oh my god.
Yeah, we have a very large bar with many things. We could maybe go upstairs and what is this going to do for my Rancor?
We're going to unleash carbonated pressure upside the Rancor's anal cavity.
I don't... Give her a persuasion.
No problem, guys. Me and my one dice have this. That's a six.
Yes! Woo! Persuaded. You want me... Okay. He goes. He calls on his comment.
Are you a doctor?
No.
We have a state-of-the-art medical droid here who needs that fizzy drink immediately. We need fizzy bip.
Fizzy bip, it is, I will call for the fizzy bip right now.
As the slogan says, we need to bip it up.
He makes a call on his comlink, and in comes another Gamorrean who's got, six 2 liters of fizzy bip drink. And you've now got one turn to decide if you want to attempt to apply this fizzy bit drink into the situation or what you're going to do with it.
What kind of medical assistance do you need?
I suggest that we each take one of these bottles, shake it as hard as we can, and in turn insert it and reach in, open it so that it sprays inward.
We're going to insert them into the anal cavity, then also reach into the anal cavity.
Yes, to unscrew the top.
At the same time.
Yes, because if we open it out here, the fizz will all be for naught.
Do you think the diameter of the anal cavity can reach a point where we can...
The Ewok went up it.
Very well.
Yeah, that's a very valid point.
So we each take...
Yeah. So you're each reaching, so you're grabbing...
So do we have to... Because I'm a protocol droid, they are not very dexterous. Do I have to roll to shake it or anything like that?
Not to shake it, but I mean, I think to get all three of your guys' arms up there. Well, okay, so you're going to have Syat do this too?
Oh, yeah, if he's willing to help.
All right, okay. So you're all giving it a good shake. Uh-huh. And Syat enters first. And gives a good spit, like there's a good space because he's got just like huge forearms, so he's really cleared a lot of space.
Great.
Why don't you guys give dexterity rolls?
All right.
No problem. Two
well, you're
1Ds.
Both very dexterous. Six.
That's a two.
Okay. So you're able to actually get all the way up in there.
Great.
And you've got like your endoscopic camera kind of like wrapped around the cap.
Great.
Part of it, so you can like easily extract it. You.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
While this is happening, SC3PO is making note of what flavors of fizzy bip they got from the bar.
Okay.
Can you tell me between, did they get plasma berry, extreme bristle melon, or puzzle flower?
They got puzzle flower and plasma berry.
Okay, great.
Yeah,
puzzle flower, clearly the superior flavor.
Like the superior flavor.
This makes sense, as extreme bristle melon is one of the most popular flavors sold by Morgeth Industries.
Huh? So you've got your hand in there, but you can't actually reach like the cap. You can't get your hand around the cap.
Uh-huh.
So you're just like grabbing the end, and the best chance that you're gonna have is gonna try to be to like break open the top and like just like crush the top so that it'll open.
Okay.
Right. So you got to do a strength roll for that. Just you. They're
okay.
They're gonna be all good.
The three.
And so you guys gonna try to do this like on the count of like.
Yes. On three. One, two, three.
Okay, so there's a huge gush of fizzy bip, and it explodes up through the cavity.
I hope
and
it reaches
actually
you,
pushes Poo Poo 2 just as you're regaining consciousness right up to the end of the colon, right up to the top of the colon.
Yes.
And you actually knock into this hard thing that's stuck right behind right behind that sphincter, right going from the small intestines into the colon.
Perfect. Puzzle flower, my favorite.
Do I need to roll for anything? I feel like I should, right? I've just rolled up against the thing and I'm awake.
Grab that obstruction.
Yeah, if you can do
dexterity?
You can do a dexterity to try to, if you were going to try to reach into the sphincter to pull the thing.
Yeah, I think I should
do
that.
You're going to do a dexterity and then you're going to do a strength roll.
Okay. Here we go. Oh, thank God.
I'm so terrified
now that I'm going to get two. Okay. What?
What'd no, you don't get one frazzle, right?
No. Yeah. No, I'm good. I'm good. Yeah. And then strength. Oh, I don't really. Where's strength? Oh, yeah, there we go. Okay. 8.
Okay. So, you're
actually
able to.
10, because it's plus 2.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
So you're able to reach through and just grab just a little bit of the edge, what feels like. You know, just a very, very hard fusion of, like, plastic and metal, mm-hmm. and you just rip it through, and you see that it's actually a helmet has gotten stuck on the other side, the other way around. Had the helmet come through the intestinal tract the other way, it probably would have been able to pass through, but because it was turned so that the actual...
breached.
Yeah. breached helmet. It was not right. Slipping through smoothly. You know?
Well, great. I'll just slide this out along with myself.
Poo-poo 2, is that you?
Yes, success.
We just sent a jet of fizzy bip up the anal cavity. Did you feel it?
Thank you. It was quite refreshing. Yes, I did, and it pushed me right to the foreign element, which I have now dislodged, and I am coming back to you.
I am making a note that for digestive troubles, anal administration of fizzy bip is the preferred method.
That may not be the most accurate piece of information to add to your database.
Well, for now, it is 100% effective.
She does have...
That makes sense.
Yeah, a point based on experience. Yeah. So, you give a little dexterity roll to see if you're able to just efficiently climb out of this thing.
Oh, it's not good for me. Not good for me at all. No. I got 6.
So 6. So, you're actually now, like, the thing that's difficult is that the cavity has kind of, like, shrunk up behind you. It might have been some sort of reaction to the acidic qualities and the fizzy bip. But the tissue seems to have gotten really inflamed and it's just really closed really tightly. And so you're not able to actually push through, like, in, like, a single round. It's, you know, it's taking you, you know, just, like, a round even to just reorient yourself so that you're actually climbing down through the intestinal tract instead of up it.
Do I need to roll for strength to see if I can just muscle my way?
Yeah, you can do a strength roll if you want to.
9.
Yeah, you're not really making very much headway right here.
Great.
Yeah.
All right. guys, I'm having a tough time. It seems that this intestinal wall is closing in at a rapid pace.
You all are doing such a bad job! No, this is horrible. We must... The Rancor is incapacitated. I have to just give Jabba a call and tell him today we cannot have any feedings. We just need to find some veterinarian hospital or something to take this thing to.
Sayat, one moment. We have dislodged the initial foreign object. There might be another foreign Ewok object up there, but we can find a way to remove that. Don't worry.
I just not doing good work right now. Very disappointed in this performance.
Do you have any more amphetamines or...
All I have left are amphetamines.
Jeez.
All right. I'll stick him with an amphetamine.
All right, so you do a little dexterity roll?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
5.
And you're able to stick him but you're not able to actually administer too much of the amphetamine before he shakes you off and breaks actually off the syringe from your arm. And so he gets just a little bit wired and...
Saya, you are crying so much. You just seem like you need a bit of an upper.
Why don't you just do something for me? I just, everything is feeling better a little bit, but I just didn't have, why can't we take care of this? No, no, we didn't take care of this. Now, I'm going to call, we'll call, maybe the big skiff, we'll take that, yeah, yes, 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 we'll take the big skiff, we'll put the Rancor on the big skiff, we'll bring it to some sort of veterinarian hospital so they don't have to deal with this sort of flip-flap job anymore. This is, why do you come here and do bad jobs? I don't like this.
To be fair, you hired temp workers for veterinarian practice out of Rancor.
Yes. We had a very good deal. We had a very exceptional discount on this desk.
By the time you have paid for the repair for the machinery that you have just broken, I fear your deal will be for naught.
I'm not paying for that. That was your fault. You do crazy things.
I was attempting to administer something to help your emotional state.
Poo-poo too. How you doing?
I'm a little warm. I'm a little wet. I'm a little sticky, and I can hear a lot of weird wailing through the walls of this animal. I'm wondering how it's going outside.
I have a theory. Syat, do you have any Rancor food here?
Yes, we have we have part of a prisoner that the Rancor didn't finish earlier. So yes, we could feed the Rancor something.
Do you have any particularly fibrous products from your industry?
Sure. We could order some Dagobah Farms fungus crackers, or shroom chips, or get Grandma Beru's sweet sand cookies.
I think we are on the same track, and I think bolstering his regular diet with something particularly packed with fiber might get the results you are looking for.
Nobody has any X-lax? Come on, guys.
So you want to just try to push your way out there again, maybe, too?
I would love to. That's a good one. Do I need to roll dexterity again, or just strength?
Just try strength roll.
Just strength. This is 8, so 10.
Okay. So you're able to push down and actually get to the place where you haven't been able to extract yourself, but you have pushed the helmet all the way to the edge.
Oh, hello.
They all interact.
Is this like a helmet is just sticking out of?
Yeah.
I reach down and try to take it out.
Okay.
Syat, look at this.
Oh, yes. You have done the good work. Yes, I like this. He
comes over and he helps you pull. And so you guys, you're going to do, you want to do a strength pull?
Mm-hmm. 5. Mm-hmm.
And you're able to pull the helmet out. And as the helmet comes out, enough space is left open that you're able actually to get all of your hand just reaching out there. It's your cyborg hand, you know?
Yeah.
So it's strong.
Okay.
Oh, hello, Poo-Poo, too.
I see that you guys did a good job pulling the helmet out. Would you mind maybe giving me a good old hand there?
Certainly.
Shall we roll for it?
Yeah, give it a roll.
All of us.
I'm holding the helmet,
six.
So I just...
Six. Ooh, 8.
And you're able to pull Poo-Poo to clear from the animal. It's like the most horrible childbirth that you have ever witnessed. Out comes Poo-Poo 2, half cyborg, half Ewok, all covered in excretia.
It strikes me that Poo-Poo 2's name has turned out to be much more literal than we anticipated.
I was just thinking that, 3PO.
I think that we're going to need to give you a bit of a hose down. Yes, that makes sense. But I just fear this Rancor is not going to be well.
Are you really still crying?
I'm very emotional. I don't know what you shot me up with, but I... Yes, no. We need to take the Rancor. We need to take it to veterinary hospital. You all must take us there. You must. Yes, you will come with us. You must finish this job, okay? We will bring the Rancor, we'll bring a skiff into the main room. We will bring the Rancor out to some sort of veterinarian hospital, and this will be coming all out of your paycheck.
Did I not fix the problem? I went through all of that.
Observational comment. The best thing for the Rancor at this point would probably be to rest in its own environment. When it wakes up, I would imagine it will be quite hungry now that we've emptied its digestive tract. And not only will this keep Jabba from being angry at you, but perhaps you may even curry some favor by doubling his portions for the day rather than making him have no food whatsoever.
Can I give a persuasion roll?
7.
What you're saying makes sense. It makes sense.
See? Permanent bedside manner.
No, this is all taking too long. We must bring the Rancor in to the veterinarian's hospital, and there it shall be. There we can do a full diagnostic, make sure that we, because what if we feed it something and then it is in pain again? Strip the prisoners before
you feed them to the Rancor.
You think we choose what we feed to Rancor? No! Jabba makes choices, throws them down whole, Rancor eats. This is not a situation. I have to deal with it. I am low man on the totem pole. This is how it works.
You can't make suggestions to Jabba? No.
Have you made suggestions to Jabba before?
No. Perhaps
no, we haven't.
Have you ever seen a quakey monkey lizard eat someone's eye out?
Perhaps we should just go and talk to Jabba and let him know that in future it would be best for him to strip prisoners before giving them to the Rancor. And then you would not have to speak to him, and we could just avoid this whole journey to the veterinary hospital.
Yeah, let's talk.
Okay. You know
what? I'm sure Jabba is a reasonable individual.
Yes, he would not have gotten to a position of such importance and influence if he was not a man of reason.
By force and pigheadedness, no way. No one can get to power that way.
All right, why don't you give a persuasion roll? All three of you go for a persuasion roll.
11.
Oh, gosh. I don't know where my persuasion is.
Persuasion is, you don't probably have a persuasion skill, right?
Big old 3.
I mean, yeah, I have intimidation, but I don't have persuasion.
Yeah, it's under perception, so you get 4D plus 1.
Oh, okay, cool. Mm-hmm.
I have a 1D on persuasion.
Okay, so from the perceived medical expertise and, you know, your one single just like sweet Ewok eye looking up at Syot, you know.
And my charming interjections.
You did not do very much, but, you know, Syot has been convinced somehow that the three of you should head up to Jabba's throne room and have a conversation with Jabba regarding taking the Rancor to the veterinarian's hospital or not.
This sounds like a very sound plan.
Wonderful plan. Let's go.
So Syot makes a call on the comlink and has the Toylik, who had guided you down to the Rancor's pit, join you.
I'm going to wipe some of that Rancor bile off of my friend here to analyze.
Okay.
Just on the way to make sure that when we get... By the time
That's
we get to Jabba...
That's not bile.
As far up as she went, there's some bile. Just to make sure my banks are full of Rancor knowledge by the time we get there.
Have I been hosed off yet? No.
Nope.
So great. The Twi'lek leads you up to what is probably, you know, the grandest room in Jabba's palace. And there is, you know, a huge court of probably the most frightening rogues gallery that any of you have ever seen.
Hello!
Many potential samples. Where do I start?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, there's probably, like, somewhere between 15 and 20 heavily armed creatures in this room. And there... Sitting at the end of this throne room is Jabba himself. The enormous hut with Salacious Crumb, the Quaking monkey littered sitting upon him. And he just appears to be telling nonstop jokes. And Jabba is just cracking up at. And everybody else also appears to be having a good laugh. there perhaps, you know, some sort of courtesy laughs you might notice, but Jabba is definitely amused.
Sorry, just so I'm clear, Salacious Crumb is telling the jokes or Jabba is telling
the jokes? No, Salacious Crumb is telling the jokes. Yeah.
Can you speak his language? Do you understand what he's saying?
I've got this. I walk up to Jabba the Hutt.
So that a photo?
And you want to take a little bit of a roll there to see if you get Santa Putties?
That's my knowledge, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That is 4?
Yeah. You have, just a working knowledge of Huttese. You don't have the full vocabulary, but you do have all the colloquial.
My grammar's not great.
No, yeah. Not great, and not very proper either. It's mm-hmm. more like, you know, just like a common talking to people in the street Huttese.
Cool.
And so what Jabba says is,
what are these two toys and half a snack looking to do with me and the rest of my rogues?
So I am in front of Jabba and I say, Uta sula tuka u Jabba sabala badia uta sila bang da da ba wang, which translates to, Lord Jabba, we are the temp workers you hired to treat your rancor. We would like to advise you that he is fine and just needs bed rest. Also, have you ever tried the delicious breakfast cereal Blaster Bites made by Morgath Industries? I think you would enjoy them.
So volta hit, so bata no for.
And what Jabba says is, oh, the rancor is fine, but I can't feed it? What's the use of having a rancor that you can't feed?
Helpful interjection. You can feed the rancor.
Do you speak Huttese?
I could roll for it.
Yeah, you can give a roll.
Yeah,
for
I have language too. Can I roll for it?
Yeah,
too?
You go for it.
4.
I have 7.
Yeah, so you guys all do understand Huttese.
Great. You can certainly feed the rancor. We would suggest that in future you strip your prisoners before tossing them down the hole, as what made him unable to eat for a while was the destruction of a helmet.
Don't fill the deal! Don't fill the and that's Kowinky Monkey Lizard, if any of you guys want to attempt to...
Oh, yeah.
I would love to.
7.
12. Oh.
10.
Yeah, so you guys all understand Koiki and Punky.
Yes!
And,
that's the dream.
And Salacious Crumb is saying, oh, you think that we have time to strip prisoners before we feed them to the Rancor? What are we running here, some kind of daycare? No, we just throw them down the hole. That's what makes it fun.
Well, perhaps you might get some enjoyment out of the humiliation that would come from depriving them of their clothing in their last moments. Perhaps you could point at the size of their genitalia and laugh, saying that it is small compared to other members of their species.
So tall.
And so, you're going to give it a little persuasion roll yeah. against Jabba the Hutt?
This probably isn't going to go well. 5.
Yeah, he is in no way convinced. You can tell by the way that his eyes just, like, slit, and he just licks very nonchalantly across his mouth, reaches in, throws in a frog directly into his gullet before he mashes down on it.
Do you find your lips dry?
What are you saying?
Lord Jabba, if you like those frogs, you may like
please
Frag's snack chips made by Morgath Industries.
Zoto!
If you're hungry, get Frag.
Zoto!
This is getting us nowhere.
Sipo, that might not be, this might not be the person to advertise to.
And what he's saying is, what did the Rancor's master Syot say to do?
Can I roll for streetwise, please?
Yeah, if you want to give
Oh, three. That helps nothing.
Do you have any ideas? You're doing a, yeah, you have no you are just terrified right now.
I'm terrified.
Yeah, it's a giant hut. People are pulling out their weapons.
I have, okay. Can I roll for intimidation?
Please roll for intimidation.
Yeah, you want to go for an intimidation roll?
Yes.
Oh my god.
Five.
Okay, literally, you're giving, like, a tough look to the crowd, and the crowd looks you in the face and just starts laughing as they unlatch their blasters and pull them out.
Oh, dear.
Soto, soto, soto. Narita, bafato.
And what Jabba said, no, 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 not blasters. If we're going to take them apart, we're going to do it slowly and painfully. They're machines. We need to make it psychologically painful.
Observation. We have done the job you hired us for. We have done nothing wrong. I really don't understand the aggression toward us at this moment.
Soto. Saifata Sayat.
And when he says this, no, what did the Rancor... What did the Rancor trainer tell you to do?
To come up here and give you our observations.
Okay,
what are you saying?
Your Rancor trainer did nothing but cry the entire time we heroically crawled up your Rancor's anal cavity.
And,
correction, I.
Well, we did put our hands in, Poopoo, too. It wasn't as if we didn't enter the beast at all.
Jabba hits a comm link. And just yells, Sayat! Sayat comes upstairs after a few tense moments. And Jabba says,
Sayat, geto pata.
And Sayat says,
I told them to take him to the veterinarian. The Rancor is still not well.
Removing him from his own environment is not going to...
Sata!
Jabba says, no, no. And looks you at the face and says,
Topata Sayat.
And says, you listen to Sayat. So, what are you guys gonna do?
Guess we're going to the vet after all.
Well, if you would like to prolong his recuperation by moving him from an environment where he's resting comfortably, that's up to you, but it goes against all medical advice that I can give you as a medical droid.
Jabba grabs another frog. Throws it in his mouth.
If you are finding that you have a persistent hunger throughout the day, perhaps try something.
Jabba hits a button, and you all slide down the tube right back into the Rancor's pit.
All right.
And the Rancor is crying.
Oh.
And Skiff comes in, lands down, and you load the Rancor onto the
skiff. We load the Rancor?
Well, you're with a group of people.
Okay. I have a strong arm. We are not strong.
I mean, yeah, you're
I have
not
one
strong.
Very strong arm.
And so with Sayat now, you're on the skiff. You're heading back towards Mos Eisley, where you've been informed that a very large animal veterinarian hospital is located. And just as you're starting to come over the crest of one of the dunes, you notice that a pair of speeder bikes and another large skiff has now come up and is flying straight at you.
Oh my, Sayat, are those more of Jabba's friends?
No, I don't know who those... I don't know. They look...
And then blaster fire starts to come.
Oh, no!
See, if we hadn't taken the Rancor out of his environment, he would never be exposed to blaster fire.
This helps nothing. What do we do now?
And there we're going to take a little bit of a break with our crew finally starting to get into, maybe not the deepest action that we've had so far in the adventure.
Ha ha, deepest action.
Yeah. But, exciting adventures await. So we'll be back from our break in just a few minutes.
Sweet. This is amazingly silly.
Does anybody need to use the rest?
Yeah.
Hey guys, welcome back to Aristocrats. We are just about to get into a fight with some mysterious strangers. And I'm here, your normal DM, not today, playing today, Clay Larson. We're here with our guest DM, Mark McCora, Lindsay Hahn,
hello,
and Jen Kruger. And if you guys want to vote, we're going to do a vote on who gets the loot at the end of this adventure. If you go to jash.com/play, you can vote there and keep watching the stream. And I think that's all I had for the moment. Mark, you want to...
should we recap?
Let's do a recap real fast, sure.
Yeah, we'll do a little recap first, and then we'll do some more chatting. But so where we're at is our droids and cyborg pirate Ewok got hired to go to Jabba's palace and work on the Rancor, who's having some medical problems in the posterior region. And the characters decided the best way to deal with that was to send the tiny Ewok up the chasm and extract chasm. What was trapped. And then for some reason, the trainer really decided that, you know, the Rancor still needed to go to the veterinarian hospital. And the three player characters did not agree with that, and so they actually demanded to go up and talk to Jabba the Hutt and try to convince him that that was the right thing to do. After some light threats of violence, they decided to follow what Jabba the Hutt wanted to do, which was listen to his Rancor trainer's advice. One question I had for you guys is, how did you all get into Star Wars? Because that was, you know, it's kind of one of those things where I started watching, like, Star Wars movies when I was a really little kid. Like, the first toy that I really remember playing with and losing was actually very similar to this one, the speeder bike. I think mine had maybe Luke on it. Mine was, of course, the original style speeder bike at the time. And being a child, I could never stop exploding the speeder bike. And I think I was at the mall or something and blew it off. And my mom was like, no, we got to go. And I couldn't find the plastic, like, front piece. I ended up losing forever. But, yeah.
That is a tragedy of a story. When you're a kid, it feels that way.
It's like the first, like, toy that you've talked your parents into buying. And then it's like you lose part of it. You're like, no!
Yeah.
I started playing, I think, Star Wars, a role-playing game when I was, like, 8 or 9 years old. And just kind of, like, really was into Star Wars, like, I think more than anything else in terms of pop culture, pretty much through, like, my 20s, dressed up as Darth Maul to go see Episode 1 when it came out, which ended up being very disappointing for me. But it was, at the time, was awesome. You know, just to be back in, like, that spirit after, like, having been a Star Wars nerd for 10-plus years and, like, gotten beaten up in junior high about it and all that kind of stuff.
Really?
Because I was playing, like one of the few times that I left the library at lunch, because I was usually just in there playing Star Wars role-playing game.
Aww.
Like, some guy just comes up and just grabs me by the throat, and he's like, what are you even doing out here, nerd? And it's like, no, you know, I'm going to go. I don't even know.
Wow.
I didn't even know that kid knew me at the time. So it was like,
popular.
How are you? Yeah, totally, secretly popular.
Like maybe he just wanted to play.
He felt left out.
He had that, you know, that Jedi urge, you know, force sensitivity or something. I don't know. So what about you guys? How did, Jen, you want to start?
I actually didn't grow up on Star Wars. The first of the movies that I saw was Episode 1 because it was coming out when I was in middle school. Mm-hmm. And I was friends with a lot of boys who were very excited to see it, and I was like, well, I'll get it since it's technically the first episode. I don't need to know any of that stuff. So we went, and I remember being a packed theater, and the crawl started, and it said something about a Jedi, and I didn't know what that was. And so to my friend sitting next to me, I said, what's a Jedi? And he just turned to me and said, like, I think as loud as humanly possible, you don't know what a Jedi is? And every head in the theater turns toward me, and I wanted to die. And then the movie sucked, and I was like, why do you guys like this this thing so much, so I was like resistant to it for a long time. I think I saw Attack of the Clones with like a boyfriend in high school, and then wouldn't see the next one because I was like, I didn't like either of those two. Screw it. And then getting into improv, you can only go so long not having seen Star Wars before you're badgered into it.
It's true.
So a few years ago for my podcast, I did an episode where there was a lot of stuff that like improv people really liked that I hadn't seen, like Back to the Future and Ghostbusters. So I was doing a thing on my podcast where it was like late to the party episodes. I would watch something that everyone else had seen. So I finally watched the originals a few years ago and really liked them. And so then when Force Awakens came out, I was like, this is so great, and loved it so much. So I'm like a new convert, I guess. But I like it. I think it's a fun universe. And I like how easy this is. The D6 system is really, really easy to pick up, especially if you have any familiarity with the D20 system. So I would play this, like, again, like, happily.
So follow-up question.
Yeah.
If you were going to introduce someone to Star Wars, mm-hmm. would you show them 1, 2, and 3, or would you just, like, skip past that and...
I honestly, if I was someone who just had no experience with any of it, I would probably show them Force Awakens, because to me it's the one that has the most relatable characters. And also, I just think BB-8 is the best thing in the entire Star Wars universe. So, but although I do love the Rancor.
Do you feel like, it feels like...
I know I'm angering people who have grown up on it, but I just...
It's okay. Lindsay's smaller than you, I think, so you can probably take her down.
Yeah. I'm going to roll for strength.
Yeah.
But don't you feel like, even though, like, the new one, like, it feels like it does lean so much on, like,
the old one.
I think it tells the same story that episode 4 tells, essentially, but I just think in a more emotionally interesting way. I find Luke to be, like, a whiny, unlikable... I'm angering everyone on the internet right now, but I really don't. I don't care for...
I think everyone on the internet can recognize that Luke is very whiny, especially.
Yeah, yeah. So, no, I mean, I think there's, like, a whole drinking game around Luke's whining.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, for me, Rey...
I have to go to Tosche Station and get some power converters!
Whereas Rey is, like, tough and cool, but she's still emotionally vulnerable, and I think that's what particularly children can relate to in a hero. Luke just seems to be, like, right place, right time kind of guy to me, whereas Rey is, like, capable.
I get that, but that's kind of in a vacuum where, like, with I feel like if someone didn't know anything and they watched Force Awakens, they'd be so confused about why do I give a shit about Han Solo.
I don't think so, because I think we're used to, with the way entertainment is now, it's much more common for stories to start in the middle. If you look at any TV show, the amount of backstory that you have to assume has happened even before a pilot episode, it's much greater than it used to be, even 10 years ago. So I don't think kids are going to be thrown by, oh, who are they looking for, whatever. And they also are like, you know, oh, he's our greatest, you know, hero, he's our greatest fighter, whatever. They say that in shorthand in the movie because they do know that children were going to see it who wouldn't have seen the other things before now. They made it so you can enter there. I think you easily can. Plus, I think Finn is much funnier than any other character I've seen in the rest of the series.
Really? You think Finn's funnier than Han Solo is?
Yeah, Han Solo.
I personally just don't find that whole... the only time that I genuinely laughed at Han is the, like, I love you, I know. And that's the only real laugh I got out of him. Well, I laughed at him in Force Awakens coming back in. Exactly.
Yeah.
Coming back in and being home and stuff. That, you know, that was like kind of a laugh, but...
Interesting.
But yeah, I just think Finn is very funny.
Okay. You okay?
I'm fine. I'm handling it. Handling it.
I feel like I don't remember the first time I saw Star Wars, but my biggest memory of Star Wars as a kid was actually later in the 80s, was like when, for a long time, I forget which channel, I think it was USA, would on Christmas Day just show the original three movies over and over and over, kind of like the way they do with the Chris... TNT, I think, TBS does with Christmas Story now. But that was great, because it would be, like, all Christmas Day just, like, hanging out with my cousins and, like, oh, I watch some of Empire, and then I go and do something else, and I come back, and, oh, the first one's on, so I'll watch half of that, and then I would...
So do you associate them with Christmas, like, strongly?
Yeah, a lot of the time.
I mean, I think that a lot of people do. When you go to Target now, there's like a light up Yoda during Christmas. It's crazy.
I think a lot of people probably associate, like, I would guess for a different reason than I am, of just like it was such a big like toy thing.
Yeah.
But for me, it's that like coming in and out of them. And so I also like have, I think I've seen them in chunks more in my life than like just watching them all the way through one by one. But yeah, that's my, like, kind of like when I got into Star Wars, I guess. There's also an element of, like, your thing, your situation aside, I feel like it's so hard to, like, I was telling someone the other day, like, oh yeah, I like Star Wars, but, like, it's like everybody on some level likes Star Wars, you know? Mm-hmm. And then there's, like, likes Star Wars.
Yeah.
And I don't even know if I would, like, classify myself as, like, that big of a fan, but, like, I like Star Wars.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's become, like, one of the main myths of our culture now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, if not, like, one of the primary, like, pop culture myths of the world.
Yeah, like, even when I hadn't seen any of the originals, in an improv scene, I was fine, because it was like, oh, I know, from just being a person who lives in the world, I know enough about, like, what this is that I could, if someone labeled me Leia in a scene, I'd be fine. And I think that's true for most people.
I will also say this, and then, sorry, Lindsay, I'll get to you in a second. We'll let you go in a second.
Please let me
You
talk.
Seem like you don't have a lot to say on
I
the subject.
I have nothing to say.
This is, like, really nerdy. I listen to audiobooks a lot, and sometimes if I don't have anything specific, I'll just look for something that's vaguely interesting to listen to. And I, starting last year, I had whatever, nothing on my wish list of stuff to listen to, and through the public library system. And so I just started downloading a bunch of the Extended Universe books. But this was after, probably like 6 months after they announced that they're no longer matter for canon.
Yeah.
So I like got there way late to the party.
Yeah. Which ones did you get into?
The Thrawn trilogy.
I mean, those are the best ones.
And then the last series, what was it called? Apocalypse or Fate of the Jedi, I think.
I didn't read those. I read like because I read the Thrawn books like right when they came out. And I remember when they, like, came out of one of my friends at camp had them, and I was just, like, my mind was blown. I was like, there's really, like, new Star Wars stories that are good, you know? And then, they kind of, like, started to peter off, you know, almost immediately after that. Like, there was one of the writers in particular I didn't like that much. And he was writing, like, a lot of them at the time. The books, they're... It's kind of too bad that they've, like, just wiped slate with them, you know? And there's, like, some talk that they might actually bring Grand Admiral Thrawn into, Is it officially announced now?
Yeah, they had the big Star Wars thing, and because I read those books, this headline caught my eye. They announced that he's going to show up in the cartoon series that's, like, part of the canon now, Rebels.
Mm-hmm.
And next season, Grand Admiral Thrawn... from the books is being introduced there, so now he is back in canon.
Yeah, so we're just getting a little comment. If it's the writer that I dislike is Kevin J. Anderson, and it was his
that I didn't. I stopped reading Star Wars book because of his Jedi trilogy.
Because of your Jedi trilogy, man, and then it's like you get my hopes up again, and then you like dash them, and then that's my real story with Star Wars, which I really It's heartbreaking to me is that it's constantly like I could get back into it and then it just like, you know, I just get like I didn't go see the new movie when it came out on the first day just to like break that pattern. Like I saw it on the first screening on Saturday morning so I wouldn't get like spoiled, you know, but I just wouldn't go see it on the first night because I was like I can't give my soul to Star Wars like this anymore.
I waited weeks for that. I waited weeks after it came out to watch it at all because I was so heartbroken by episode one. I was so heartbroken. My time to shine. The Star Wars, everything. It was more of like religion in my family. Like some families have religion. We had Star Wars, especially in my dad's family. Like my uncle has a ton of the original toys. Chandler Haan. He has a bunch of pictures on his Facebook, I think. I've handled the original toys. They're all in like Ziplocs, and I grew up with this like they were like. Relics. They were sacred relics that every once in a while we were allowed to play with. And I used to go to my grandma's house every weekend, and the movies that she had that I could watch were Star Wars and Romancing the Stone. So I loved Star Wars. I loved them all. I love Romancing the Stone too. And I just watched them over and over and over and over again. I don't remember the first time that I watched Star Wars. But I really loved Han Solo because my last name is Han, so I thought that like somehow that gave me like a deeper connection to him.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. I have a band called the Han Solo Project. That's my Twitter handle, H-A-U-N. I was so in love. And I remember I was like 8 years old when my dad, we were driving down Galt Street in Van Nuys, when we lived in Van Nuys, and I remember the day that he told me that there were other stories other than just the three movies. And I was like, it was like the most exciting thing I had ever heard, but I was also so angry that they hadn't been made. And that, and my dad was like, yeah, they're talking about possibly making them again, but the actors are going to be so old. And I was like, what are you talking about? Like, I thought that there was going to be more with, like, Princess Leia and Han Solo and Luke. And I was, like, I was excited and also, like, heartbroken and also just, like, so angry. Like, it was, like, my first touch with, like, I mean, my first taste of being angry that there were forces more powerful than me that were making the world something that I didn't want it to be. You know what I mean? And I remember just like trying to figure out a way that I could get the movies made. And then I went to a bookstore and I found the books and I started reading. I don't remember which book. I started reading one of the books and I was so disappointed. It must have been one of the ones from the crappy writer. I don't know. I just couldn't bring myself to read anything after that.
Yeah.
I just couldn't. I was so heartbroken just from like the first couple of pages that I just couldn't even deal with it. And so I made up a bunch of stories in my head, but it didn't. The episode one did not.
How does this table help. Break down then in terms of Force? Because you liked Force Awakens though, right? Even though you waited a long time to see it.
So I think I had such low expectations for the Force Awakens that that I was really blown away by how fun it was. Like just as a fan, it was really fun to see all my favorite characters and to see them now and what they're doing and obviously it was super cool to see a female Jedi, which is something that I always wanted, and I kind of got pushed into feeling like I needed to identify with Leia, who is very cool, but who, you know, I wanted to be more powerful than that. So like politically, I'm super stoked that there's like a chick and a black guy, you know what I mean? That's amazing. And so that made me really stoked about it. But it is a little annoying that she didn't have to go through training to get to be as good. That was something that was hard, because, you know, Luke, we sort of watched this like amazing journey for him, like accepting his shadow, you know, like this whole like psychological, the hero's quest, the whole thing. And so that it happened so fast for her, that was a little hard for me to swallow.
A lot of JJ movies is that he doesn't have really very much training happening before people get like to the height of their power. But
yeah,
you know what I mean? That's...
Do you feel like, because to me, it seemed like they were setting up that the next movie would be that for
yeah,
her.
Yeah, that's what
I just don't understand how she was able to be so good.
Right.
No, I mean, I think if you look at her lineage, like, she's inheriting a certain amount of,
I mean, but
you know,
that
skill
wasn't
and
true
sensitivity.
With Luke.
And
you know what I mean?
And to get into Kevin J. Anderson land, actually, like, it seems like she was at some sort of Jedi Academy or something. So it's like maybe she had childhood training and then like that all like, you know, got repressed in some sort of like memory, you know, thing.
Yeah, she does
an
have
actual
some...
memory wipe or like not a memory wipe, but
yeah, but now we're going deep into like theory.
Way into
yeah.
theory.
Yeah.
Way into theory territory.
I see your point, absolutely. I guess, I've been thinking about in terms of, like, to me it feels like very much a movie thing of, like, she's going to get that in the next movie. But for now, we had to have a cool fight scene.
Yeah.
So, like.
Yeah, and I feel like they could have, I don't know, done something. I didn't care as much as I would have liked to have cared. Because I knew that it needed to go to another movie. And I knew that, you know, this, she's up against him. Like, there's no way she could be captured now. Although that would be awesome. Like, Han Solo gets frozen at the end of a movie, you know? Luke Skywalker loses his hand. Like,
yeah.
Spoiler alert. but, you know, like, there were real stakes. And I feel like this was just, like, all three episodes, like, put in, you know, all three of the original episodes put into one movie to like and it was satisfying for me to watch it, but at the same time, like walking away from it, I didn't have the same existential satisfaction that I do when I watch the original three.
That's an interesting point too, because I hadn't thought about this, but in the first movie, in episode 4, because Luke doesn't have like a big, you know, lightsaber fight or anything at the end, he goes on a hunch of, I think I can use the Force in this way, but it's all like X-Wing, you know, dropping the bomb and everything. Like, I hadn't thought about that, but that isn't like the same as having a lightsaber fight with a powerful Sith lord. Like, I hadn't thought about that. Yeah, it's a good point.
So where do you go? You're pretty good on it, right? Like, you think it's okay?
I liked it. The further away I get from it, the more I go from, that was amazing, to, that was really fun.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's, I end up feeling like, it was good. What's next? / I don't know that, and this also might just be come from the fact that we're older now, but, like, I don't feel like it's, you know, affected me, or like, you know, it's not going to be something I look to as like an influence.
Yeah.
You know, but that also might just be from being older.
The thing that I miss from the humans too, that I feel like the original three episodes had, like especially Leia and Han, is they had like this sort of edginess to them that I feel like our new characters are missing a little bit.
See, I wonder if that's the experience of seeing it as a child versus an adult, because everything that you're saying about your impressions of like wanting to watch Luke go through all this stuff, I as an adult watching it was like, let's go, come on, stop whining and pick up the fucking lightsaber already. Like, I really didn't, he was my probably least favorite part of the entire experience.
Certainly least favorite part.
And I feel
we
like...
We love you, Mark Hamill.
Sorry.
the thing that's weird is I really like Mark Hamill. I have that with certain actors. Like, I love Billy Piper. I fucking hate Rose. That's a Doctor Who thing for anyone in the chat. But the I feel like Rey. I could connect to her immediately and have that same like draw and want to watch her. That it sounds like you had with Han as a kid, and so it might just be like different of like different age experiencing them.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, it could definitely be that. But I still think that the journey is longer and it's more drawn out, and it's a little less like goal focused and a little bit more journey focused in the original episodes.
And I will also say, just knowing you, since you are a screenwriter, I feel like that also to me is like,
that's true. Mm-hmm.
Might explain that feeling of watching the originals and being like, come on, let's go.
Yeah.
Because you're like inherently thinking about structure and everything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
true. I think probably the other thing too, like in terms of like, you know, age and not just like how old we were when we saw it, but the movie I think was so visually exciting when it first came out.
Yeah,
that
for
of course
me,
by
like,
the time you saw it, you had been seeing those kinds of visual films for like 20 years. So it's like seeing that Star Destroyer pull in for the first time is like...
Yeah, it was like, oh, okay.
Yeah. Oh, okay. And then
you had probably already seen like that made fun of so many times.
Yeah. For me,
in saw the original.
Watching the originals, it's funny because it was like, I kept having to remind myself, like, for the time, this looked great. But what I was actually impressed with is the parts where there is matte painting. It's some of the most beautiful matte painting I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And no one ever said that to me about those movies, really, or maybe a couple people had, but it was mostly like,
that's surprising since I know how many matte painting discussions you have.
I know, I talk about matte painting all the time and no one brings it up, but yeah, that I did find really, especially because at that time it wasn't a prevalent thing anymore, and so it was a cool choice to make for those movies to do the amount of matte painting that they did.
Oh, yeah, and like when I was a kid, they had a Star Wars art show where they had all the props out, like in San Francisco at this big gallery space. And even there, like the matte paintings were just like so gorgeous to look at in person. It's just amazing. You know?
Yeah.
Oh God, I would love to have seen
But that. I think we can all agree that Finn and Rey are great characters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
what were we doing now?
I think we're playing an adventure. And there's a battle.
I feel like we healed this rancor and we should head back. That's just me.
Oh.
Oh, no. I rebuild my dice tower.
There's an earthquake here in L.A. We didn't do that accidentally. All right.
So
that conversation went so much longer than I was expecting.
Me too.
How entertaining was that?
So hope you like talking about matte paintings, guys.
Love it. So where we ended up, you know, we had a skiff
with our adventurers, along with our Rancor and our Rancor trainer, who are flying back towards Mos Eisley. And then across the dunes, we have another skiff that has four people on it, along with two speeder bikes that are speeding as fast as they can at you all right now, and they have their blasters actually firing.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
Is the Rancor, Rancor just like out? Is he making sounds still?
It seems like it's pretty sleepy right now as a Rancor goes. It's definitely like making some, you know, snoring and still a little bit of maybe like, you know, whiny, disrupted kind of sounds, but nothing like it was. And I mean, the opioids, the high dose of opioids did seem to actually take it down a little bit.
And can I look at, tell me what you might want me to roll for this.
Uh-huh.
I wanna look at Syot and see if Syot seems surprised that these guys are showing up.
Ooh, okay. I like that.
Let's take a little roll.
Because he really wanted us to bring
Yeah, he
this.
Really did.
Hmm.
I think that you would be making a perception.
Great. Roll. One dice, no problem.
Good luck.
Six. It's the best I could have done.
Yeah. So, yeah, you notice that Syot does not seem to be very, like, deeply concerned about what's happening right now. He's definitely slipped down a little bit under the guardrail of the skiff.
Uh-huh.
He also seems to be moving towards the controls of the skiff.
Excuse me, Mr. Syot, do you know these folks?
What are you trying to say? I don't know these people. We need to, they're coming to take the Rancor. We cannot let the Rancor be taken.
But how would they know the Rancor would be out here?
I don't know.
How do you know they're coming to take the Rancor?
It's obvious, isn't it? It's flying towards us right now. I don't know. Why are you questioning me? Why would I want someone?
Oh, there's the waterworks again.
And so Syot reaches over quickly, grabs the controls of the repulsor, and crashes it into the dunes. And the skiff crashes.
Oh, no!
You're all,
can I try to use my blaster to defend us?
You'll have to make a dexterity roll right now.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
That's another six.
A one. 15, no. 17.
Yeah, a one.
Oh, no.
So you are thrown clear of the skiff, land upside down.
Great.
Into a dune. You, like, essentially get thrown up and then come and land down on your butt so you're sitting down.
Oof!
Yeah. And you have stayed perfectly on balance.
Unlike these books.
Unlike this book. You have stayed perfectly on balance and just kind of surfed the skiff down.
Yes!
And Syot...
Excellent work, Poo-Poo 2!
Syot basically rolls off the back of the skiff and into the sand.
Okay.
The group of marauders come and land their speeders down next to the skiff, and all come off it with their blasters drawn.
Do I recognize like what species they are, or like are they anybody I've seen at Jabba's palace or anything like that?
There are a mix of Tufts. I mean, there are some, like, you know, some Gamorreans in the group. There are a lot of people wearing body armor, so you can't really tell what species they
are.
But they definitely appear to be kind of like Tufts more than anything else.
Oh, no! 2-1-B! 2-1-B, are you all right?
I believe so. I just have to extricate myself here.
Wiggle back out of that dune.
How deep into the dune was?
I
think I just sort of landed upside down.
Yeah, as are you going to go help?
How close am I?
Probably like 5 meters or something.
Sure, I guess I'll get up and go over to try to help pull her out.
Okay, all right.
Poo Poo 2 seems fine.
Yeah, yeah.
Meanwhile.
Poo Poo 2 is totally fine. And Syot reaches behind him, pulls out a knife and a vibroblade, and points it at Poo Poo 2. He's like, "Now you're going to stand down, and we're going to take this rancor."
Okay. Should I use my business knowledge? Yeah, intimidation.
Okay. Yeah, you.
Nobody knows more about business than Ewoks.
That's right.
Well, what do you want to do?
Well, possibly negotiate.
Okay.
Does that sound crazy?
No. Yeah, if you want to try to. Because
I feel like I could maybe intimidate, but there's a lot of people here.
I think that a bargain is probably
bargain?
Your best role
okay.
right now.
Okay. Let's do
if
that.
That's what you want
that's
to do.
Great.
Is some sort of bargaining.
All right. Let's do a bargain. Oh, thank God. I'm so worried I'm going to roll 2 6s. Okay, so I can't do math right now. 13.
13.
13, yeah.
But then 14.
Oh, 14, yeah.
14, okay. And so what are you going to try to bargain with him?
Oh, shoot. That's kind of, what exactly are you, I assume you're here for the beast.
This rancor deserves freedom. It has been tortured for so long. It is my baby and I love it. And Jabba doesn't care. Jabba, this is just a toy for Jabba. But no, I care for the rancor. I don't want it to eat this armor anymore. I don't want it to be tortured like it is down in its little hole. It deserves to run free. Free out in the dunes of the desert where it can feast on cracked dragons.
Oh, this is actually quite reasonable, and as much as I'm all for animal rights, we do have a certain obligation to our employer.
Also, I am afraid that Jabba might think that we stole it if you steal it.
Correct!
That is exactly what my plan is.
All right, see,
oh dear.
This is where... There's the rub. all right.
At this point, they've dragged the rancor off the skiff, and two of the Tufts are pointing their blasters directly at you.
Okay, okay.
Have I helped 2-1-B get out of the dunes yet?
Yes.
I look at this shiny necklace I have. It's a wolf, and with a crescent moon and lots of beading. It looks like it's sacred and worth lots of money. What
like
about
to
this
spend
for the
that sacred, this time with your sacred little trinket saying some prayers
right,
before you are buried in the desert.
Argon didn't
want medical you. Observation. I have finished analyzing the sample from the rancor that I took earlier off Poo Poo 2 here, and it seems to me that this particular beast has a terminal case of cancer. It is unlikely to survive past the next 6 months, and if you are to release it into the dunes, it will be unlikely to be able to fend for itself and hunt these dragons you're speaking of.
You don't think I know that? That's why I want it to be free, so that it can run through the desert for 6 months instead of being captured like it is in the darkness.
Well, it is unlikely to be able to run much longer at all. I don't know if, all of the radiation on the ship is what gave it the cancer in the first place or how it happened, but it is too weak to exist out here on its own.
Do you want
to
give a persuasion roll?
Yeah. 3.
What sort of cancer is it?
Can I make...
Yeah.
Can I pitch in?
Yeah.
If I may, perhaps before you release it into the wild, you should have a available medical droid take a look at it once more.
That is a very good idea, yes. Yes. You medical droid, you go and look at the rancor. You make sure the medical droid is... You've got your information. You tell me what we can do to fix it now. And maybe I won't bury you here in the desert.
Can I say something to her, like,
yeah,
low before mm-hmm. she walks? Because are they far enough away from us that I could say something quietly to 2-1-B?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially because, droids, you can, like, communicate and, like...
Wirelessly?
Or something. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Adrenaline shots. Wake
yes,
it up.
Yes, that was my plan.
Just making sure we're on the same page. Okay.
I find as droids, we have a lot of the
same idea.
I'm gonna head over toward the Rancor, and it's gonna get the rest of the amphetamine that I've got, and then maybe a little laser tap to the bottom to kind of just spur it along.
All right, you wanna give that just a? I think that you should do some maybe sort of sneak.
Okay.
With that, if you want it to appear as if you're not, to do it in a way that you're not immediately recognize what you're doing, because they are still pointing the blasters.
Right. What would sneak
neither of
be?
Us have
we
sneak.
We don't have sneak.
Okay. Just roll a perception roll.
Perception. Okay. 11.
What are you doing over there with that Rancor? So you have to now make a dexterity to see if you can actually get it.
Okay. I am taking an additional sample. It will only take a moment. 4.
4? Okay. Yeah, so you stick the Rancor, and you're able to apply the shot.
Great.
But they start blasting at you. Okay. Once you, so you need to now take another dexterity roll to see if you can dodge.
2. I am not a fast droid.
And so you are hit by 2 blasters.
Oh no, 2-1-B!
And, and you are immediately frazzled and incapacitated.
Oh, no.
And fall back down into the sand. But the Rancor.
Oh no.
So how much amphetamine? You said you plugged him with all the amphetamine?
All of the amphetamine that I had, yeah. All
right.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah, I think it would have been, yeah.
Yeah, and, so the Rancor immediately reels up. And just starts swinging its huge arms.
Ooh.
And taking out pretty much like anything that's around it. And so you two need to make a dexterity roll to see.
Us two.
Yeah, to see if the Rancor. Or actually, do you want to try to dodge? Do you want to try to hide?
I have beast riding.
Or do you want to try to...
Yeah, ride that Rancor.
So you
want to
ride the Rancor?
That's your plan. Try to ride the Rancor.
Now in this
system, that's gonna be a 2-stage kind of process.
Okay.
We'll have Clay make his rolls for us.
Yeah, I'm not gonna try and ride the Rancor. Is dodge, just because I don't know the system well, is like making a dexterity check. Is using dodge a better, like, do I roll more or something, or do I still just roll the 1D for dexterity either way?
I think right now you're going to roll just the 1D.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll just try to, dodge out of his way.
Yeah.
6.
Nice.
6. Okay, so...
It's still just the 1 die, so it might not be enough.
Based on where you're at, you're able to dive under the sand.
Oh!
Because you're so heavy, you actually do sink into the sand just a bit, enough so that you're pretty much completely hidden with it.
So I dive, and then as I land, sink a little.
Sink a little bit down. Sand closes over top of you.
On the blue and white paint job.
Is sand closing on me where I fell, too?
Yes. But you're like...
I know I'm incapacitated.
You're totally incapacitated.
I'm just imagining these two droids just like sinking in.
Oh dear.
Not sinking like in like a interminable quicksand kind of thing. It's more that you've just like sunken into the top layer of the sand.
We're depressing this top of the sand.
Exactly. Well, it's you're being covered by the sand. It's like you're getting buried at the beach.
Uh-huh.
Great. Mm-hmm.
Great.
And
now ride that Rancor.
the other players right now, or the other characters.
Telling you, that Rancor is gonna be hungry. We emptied out its system.
That's probably true. Okay. So the Rancor takes 3 huge swipes and knocks down 3 of the 3 of the guards.
Nice.
One is able to kind of like roll away from the action, and Syok just starts like kind of like stepping back and crying and saying, "No, no!
I'm your papa, please, no, no. And so you want to now take your...
Yeah.
So that's your dexterity roll, right?
Seven, yeah. Okay. Oh, wait, wait. I have 13.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. No. I have 12. I have 12.
Six. Yeah.
Hello.
This is to get up on the Rancor?
This is to get up on the Rancor. Yeah, you're able to get, like, you're able to grab, like, the little tail of the Rancor.
Yeah.
But now you have to do another roll to see if you can actually climb up the Rancor.
Okay, another mechanical
and
roll?
And while you're doing, no, this is going to be, this
dexterity.
Is going to be, yeah, another, you can do another mechanical roll. I think the beast riding kind of fits.
Okay.
And while this is happening, the Rancor.
It's not terrible.
It frits out.
I have 10.
Yeah. It'd be a bad time.
Yeah, bad
time.
Really bad time. Yeah.
So you slip, but you're able to hold on to the tail still. So now you're like hanging, like swinging on the Rancor tail. And the Rancor is just like going to town on these guards who are now trying to like blast it with the blasters. And Syot, during this time, is actually grabbed one of the blasters from the fallen guards and is trying to protect the Rancor
from the other guards.
From the other guards. Yeah.
If he shoots one of the guards and feeds it to him, he might calm down.
he just might do that. The Rancor is in such a crazy amphetamine buzz right now that he actually grabs Syot and takes a big chunk out of him, bites off pretty much his whole left arm and a bit of his shoulder, and is now you know, holding on to like the rest of his body with one hand. His side is just screaming and wailing in pain, and Syot, you know, is bleeding profusely, and he passes out very quickly. And the Rancor continues to eat him, but there's still these there's still two guards that are left, and you're hanging down by the tail, and the droids are hidden in the sand right now,
powered down, oh my God. I'm just face down.
Totally.
Can I yell something?
Yeah, go ahead.
So SE-3PO is face down in the sand, kind of like this, but like moving its legs and arms like this in the sand, and just yells out, "What's happening? Oh no, who is that? Save me, Poo-Poo-Too!"
So what are you gonna do, Poo-Poo-Too? What is your kind of like the main...
I feel like I need to get control of this beast so that we can take it back. I mean, this is our mission. Like, otherwise we fail the mission, right?
Yeah.
Like, I feel like, okay, so I'm more beast riding roles.
Okay,
is
yeah,
that...
you need to do another beast riding role?
Oh,
yeah, that makes
right.
sense.
I have 9.
No, 10.
Oh, no, 10. Nope.
Yeah, 7, 8, 9, 10, right?
No, that's set. Oh, my God, I thought that was a 1. Yes, 10.
Well, so the Rancor, though, is, like, pretty enraged still and has tossed Syot aside and is really trying to reach back and throw you off. And ends up tossing you kind of into the edge of the skiff.
Oh, crap.
So you're... you end up getting a little bit dazed.
Okay.
But you're still good. So what are you going to do right now? The Rancor is like standing, getting blasted by a couple of the blaster rifles, which don't seem to be doing much to it, and just like screaming, yowling in pain.
Oh my God. Okay, I have a blaster. Should I use the blaster to hit?
The blasters don't seem to be doing much.
Not to him, to the guys that are hurting the Rancor, right? Because we can't bring the Rancor back hurt.
Yeah.
That seems like how, a fine idea to
yeah,
do.
Yeah, yeah, right?
I'm face down in the sand. Yeah, so
are you going to try to get out or anything?
I am just trying to get out.
Okay, you want to do a roll for that?
That would be great. I would love some help.
As a face down droid with no weapons, I am struggling even to get up.
You're definitely struggling.
What is this?
Sand.
What is this? What roll?
Dexterity. This would be a dexterity roll.
I mean, it doesn't matter. It's 1D for everything.
Not knowledge.
Three.
So you're able to slip out of the sand like and push yourself up so that you're now like on your side, kind of sitting on the sand. So maybe next turn it'll be easier for you to be able to actually push yourself off. The Rancor.
Oh, I'm going to have sand in my servos for weeks.
How long am I incapacitated for?
Let me see.
Because I do have a laser I can attack with.
Yeah, you are you're like electronics are just rebooting. Starting to reboot.
Okay.
But you're probably like a turn from being able to get up.
Okay. Cool.
What about you, Lindsay? Are you gonna try anything more poo poo too?
Okay. I can use my blaster. I can try to intimidate the beast, but I feel like maybe that's a little silly. So I think I'm going to use my blaster against the guards that are obviously hurting him.
Yeah.
All
right. 8.
Okay, so you are able to hit one of the guards. It's just like kind of like a flesh wound kind of shot. So it's not like a headshot. The guard is slowed, but doesn't go down. The Rancor is very quickly starting to become tired of fighting these guards. Grabs one of them by the head, crushing it. And then smashing the other guard with.
Oh, that's great.
Well, that's helpful. Yeah. That's great.
All right. I guess I should try and ride it more.
Probably. I mean, probably try it.
That's the only thing I feel like we can do other than running.
14, 15,
16. 17,
18. Wait. 10, 14. It's mechanical, right? So 16.
Yeah. He's better. Maths.
Yeah, so you are now actually able to get up on top of the Rancor around its neck.
Yes.
And, you know, for whatever reason, it feels calmed by this. Maybe it's this deep connection that you've shared throughout the course of the last few hours. But the Rancor, or maybe it's, you know, just that the amphetamines are starting to run out of its system because it's a huge beast. But the Rancor now seems to be very tired and goes down on its fists and then sets itself down onto the skiff.
It's still
conscious, but it's sitting. So you are now perched atop the Rancor. Tiny little cyborg pirate Ewok, you do have control of it. So,
what do we do now?
I don't know. You guys want to try to? You're not conscious.
Great.
You pushed yourself up.
Yeah. I'm still sitting though.
Yeah, you're still sitting.
Hooray, Poo Poo Too!
I'm gonna try and get out of the sand.
Okay.
I want to stand up and go, I guess, look at Sci-Hut and just see how he's doing.
I detect injury.
Is he alive at all?
Is his head clean off? I mean, his head isn't clean off, mm-hmm. but he is bleeding out like an incredible amount. And he's just like, you don't understand.
Greetings, Sci-Hut.
The torture that they put this Rancor through. If you had seen it, if you had raised it like I was.
If I could take some of that blood you are currently letting out as a sample, I might be better able to help treat your wounds.
I don't think his wounds are treatable.
Oh, don't worry. You'll feel better soon.
Okay, so let's do...
A persuasion roll with that? Are you going to try anything else eight? Other than a blood sample?
Well, eight for that persuasion roll. Yeah, I'll take the blood sample and then...
Syed has stopped crying as much as...
I'll try to stop his bleeding.
Okay. So what you've got is you've got your laser tool.
Yeah, I'm going to cauterize the wound, I guess.
Yeah.
Which is, I mean, it's like not going to feel good, but... 14.
Yeah, so you are able to cauterize the wound.
Great.
Syat is screaming out in pain as you cauterize the wound.
Oh, tut tut you.
I know, but on the other side, it will be better.
We're going to bring you back to Jabba so you can explain your actions.
No, don't do that. Don't do that, please. Just kill me. Kill me now out here in the desert, please.
Oh, no, I could never...
To the hut.
I could never murder you. You already gave me a sample. I don't need to dissect you entirely.
Oh, please, please, anything. Don't take me to Jabba the Hutt, please, anything in that. Just release me out in the desert. Say that I died out here during... And you bring the Rancor back. That's all you need to do. That's all Jabba really cares about.
Don't you care about how the Rancor ends its life for the next 6 months?
I'll be the Rancor's next meal! Please, please, let me live! Let me live!
I feel very persuaded by this argument. I would like to let him live. I'm also actually feeling for the Rancor at this point and feeling like maybe, you know, my ultimate life mission is to bring something really amazing back to my tribe, and this Rancor might...
You want to take a Rancor in a space ship?
Well, we have a connection.
I would like to see this beast live out the rest of its limited time in as much comfort as possible. If you were suggesting that your tribe would be able to provide it a comfortable existence, I am fully in support of your plan, Poopootu.
I think it will.
Well.
Does this ruin our entire trip?
This is an interesting plan. How are you going to propose to fulfill it?
Well, as far as Jabba knows, we were taking the Rancor to the veterinarian with Syed, as was what he wanted to happen. If we return to the temp agency and simply tell Tlycon Mybar that we transported the Rancor to the veterinarian per his Syed's request, I don't see why he would check on that before the end of a business day.
Could we also possibly fabricate some sort of records and hack into the system and make it seem like the Rancor is in the veterinary office? Could we also do that?
That would take some pretty extreme computer programming skills, right. If any of you have
one. If I attach to a medical computer, I can certainly attempt to... Oh, I could download so many records. Yes, let's go to the veterinarian's office.
Do we know how, like, they verify... Have we worked for this temp agency before? Do we know, like, how they verify if we've completed the job or anything?
You want to ask... I think that the person that would be verifying it would be... Syot would be the person who would verify it. So maybe if you guys... Or if you're talking about this in front of Syot, is this all an open conversation in front of him? He's like, yes. I will say that you have done your job. If you let me go into the desert, then yes.
Then how will you reply that we've done the job?
Perhaps we can
calm them right now. We'll calm them right now. We'll calm to the temp agency that everything is okay, that you have done a wonderful job. And then what I will do is I have a spaceship. I have a starship.
Perfect.
That was my next question, how we were going to get it off the planet.
That we can then, yes, we can bring the Rancor to the starship and...
And then go to Endor. Then,
yes, if that's what we'll do, yes, that sounds like a fine plan to me.
How big is your starship?
It's a tramp freighter. It can definitely fit the Rancor.
Excellent.
Excellent. Okay, then we have agreed. Then I will call Tycon right now, and he gets on the comm and calls up Tycon.
Yes.
And he says,
And he says, "Oh, Tlycon, I cannot thank you enough for what wonderful work you temp people have done. They did just exceptional work. They were able to cure the Rancor of its issues, and now they will, now we will all go together to live together. Exceptional pain here! Mental capacity, very limited by pain.
Tut, tut, your wounds have been cauterized.
Cauterized? But I have no pain medication still.
I have a first aid skill. Maybe I have some aspirin.
No, I don't think that's going to work.
Or a galactic equivalent.
So Tlycon replies, "Oh, yes, very good. I'm so glad to hear that this job has gone well with my employees. I will transfer credits into their account immediately, and we shall be able to decide what...
Are you falling asleep, Tlycon?
Yes, I haven't had enough chai today. Excuse me. I will make quick work of this credit transfer." And he types in a couple of keys, which you can see from the video panel on the comm link. And you all have a message on your comm panels that 300 credits apiece have been transferred into your accounts. You lead the Rancor onto the skiff. Mm-hmm. And fly towards the hangar.
Hooray, nothing can stop us now.
Do I have a connection to, like, the net or whatever? Basically, can I immediately, as soon as I get that money, invest it in Morgath Industries stock?
Well, you guys probably, you were going to want to stop at a computer panel at the hangar before taking out, you know, or before taking off. And, if you want to do a computer programming role to get access to the stock.
Four?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, you're in, because it's very easy to do that.
I'd love to connect to whatever the Star Wars version of WebMD is.
Yeah.
Just download as much as I can.
Yeah, go ahead.
Why didn't you do that earlier?
Friends, would any of you like to invest in a very excellent company called Morgath Industries?
No, but thank you.
I choose not to. No, thank you.
You're downloading the information very quickly into your memory banks. Sad is like, "We need to leave now before Jabba hears any rumors about a Rancor coming into Mos Eisley and not going to the veterinarian's hospital. We need to hit the stars immediately."
All right, I can learn the rest of this later or on the road. I learned so much simply by collecting samples earlier.
Real quick question. So if I invested 300 credits, does that show up in my inventory as like a certain amount of stock, or how would that work?
I think that after the split, the Morgath Industries is like something like $100 a share or something, so you get 3 shares.
Great.
For that.
No money, 3 shares of Morgath Industries stock.
Yeah. I think that the only thing for us to do now is figure out who's gonna get this loot, because the thing that happens very very quickly on the flight off of Tatooine is that Syot actually succumbs to his wounds.
Aww.
and passes away.
I have failed
because he had lost so much blood. Out there in the desert.
Hello, Syot.
So
Syot.
There are no more signs of life, I'm afraid, Sipo.
Syot.
He's gone.
So, Syot regains consciousness for a moment.
Whoa.
And says to 2-1-B, "This ship, this Rancor, is now yours."
Mine?
Enjoy.
Excellent!
Why did he give it to you?
I tended his wounds, I diagnosed the Rancor, I woke the Rancor back up to attack the people who were going to kill us. I mean, I feel like I contributed a lot.
Yeah, that's not bad.
I did go up his butthole and, you know, ride the beast, but whatever, it's fine.
Yes, and you got stuck, and we put Fizzy Pop up there to get you out. I mean, I don't want to nitpick,
but... I'm happy, no, I'm happy we're friends.
I think you guys all did a really, really great job with this adventure.
To be fair, I gave many facts about blaster bites, the flavor bass blasted part of your complete breakfast.
So, at the end of, a Star Wars adventure, what we also do is we give out character points for people to be able to improve their skills. That's how things work within the 6D universe. So I will give 15 character points to Poo Poo 2. I will give 12 character points to you for your research, and I'll give since you got the loot, I'll also give you 13 character points.
Cool,
nice.
And those you can either hold on to for future games when you're having a really difficult kind of task. What we do in the D6 universe is that we actually get to add dice using either character points or force points. And, I'm going to give you a force point, too.
Yes!
Just because you had such a deep connection with the Rancor.
Yes.
I feel like there was some sort of communion that happened there that was beyond, regular communion. There was a spirit communion that happened there.
So, for example, if I was making a roll to try and buy stock in Morgoth Industries, I could roll 13 dice.
Well, yeah, you can add a die with a character point. And
and what better use of a character point than adding a die to buy stock in Morgoth?
Really get in there.
Excellent.
And then a force point, if you were to spend that in a situation within the system, what it does is it actually doubles the amount of dice that you're able to roll in that particular moment.
Oh, cool.
So, like, if let's say you were going to do a perception roll or a dexterity roll, you would get 60 or 80 in that moment. And based on how you use that and why you use that, you can either be given another force point. You can, if you're doing something that's very honorable, if you're doing something that's very neutral, you would then lose the force point. And if you do something that's evil, you would get a dark side point. Mm-hmm. And a dark side point is actually going to pull you closer and closer to the dark side, which as a cyborg, you would, have more of a chance to get pulled towards the dark side than
become
an evil character. So,
cool.
Yeah. So that is, that's the close of the game.
We did it!
Yay! Yes!
We perfectly completed that adventure.
Exactly, as was intended.
Yeah, well, and it's funny because I was not actually thinking that that you guys would get up into Jabba's throne room.
Or up into that Rancor's butt.
Or up into that Rancor. Like, I thought that there was maybe some, easier solutions to that problem than just sending the Ewok up the butt to start with.
No, man. Occam's razor.
Yeah.
Always send the Ewok up
the butt.
Up the butt. I think that's it then, guys.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming on the show and playing. Mark, thank you so much for DMing.
Yeah. No, thank you guys for having me.
Thank you for getting me the chance to play one character a game instead of many. And guys, thank you so much for everybody. Does anybody have anything they want to plug?
Oh.
Twitters or websites or shows or anything.
I'm making a lot of movies with my production company Happy Canyon Club, so you can keep updated at happycanyonclub.com.
Nice.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. You can check out my website, whoismarkmacora.com. I have some videos there. And you can, if you want to, search for the Somewhere Else Tonight video for Mansions on the Moon, which I directed and acted in, and Lindsay acted in as well.
Oh, nice.
So
cool.
It's a pretty cool, it's got some kind of adventure-y feels to it, too.
Nice.
My Twitter is HooraryJen, HooraryJen. And then if you want to hear any of those podcasts I was talking about, that's prepopculture.com. You can hear me talk about Star Wars or a ton of other nerdy stuff. There's a D&D episode too.
And I run a show called Aristocrits on Twitch. thank you so much for watching, everyone. Like we said earlier, if you want to check out older episodes, you can go to youtube.com/jashplay. And next week, we'll be back to doing D&D like normal. On a nighttime episode, we'll be playing at, or we're going to figure it out, but we think about 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on Wednesday night. And there will still be a older nighttime episodes streamed live on Thursday afternoon at 3 p.m. So, Wednesday night or Thursday afternoon next week, you can get your fix of D&D. And we hope you guys come back again sometime.
This was so fun. I definitely would.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, thanks so much, guys. Are we going to do a Q&A or are we running? All right, we're going to do a quick break, and then we'll be back if you want to stick around. We'll do a quick like, little Q&A where we'll be in the chat, and if you guys have any questions you want to ask us directly, we'll do that. Yay. Thanks, guys.